This is the SleepyCast season finale, featuring
Stamper, Rice Pirate, Oni, Psychic Pebbles, Spaz Kid, Nile, Johnny Utah,
and
Tom Fulp. My name is not really Captain Dickhead. I have been living a lie. All my stories, everything I've ever said, it is a lie. One day the truth will be revealed, but not today. Today I have a doctor's appointment because my pee-pee is coming out like cottage cheese. See you in another life.
There is a world as tangible as our own, impossible to see yet unavoidable to sense. A world enveloped by a seemingly unending ocean of forests. Buried deep in that forest, tucked away neatly within a blanket of twilight, lies a quaint little cabin. And in that cabin...
It's a season of Jesus! Shut up! God, it's a season finale! It's a SleepyCast season finale! God, fuck!
Now he's gonna move.
More powerful than a grizzly, more agile than a cougar, with reflexes faster than two cobras combined. It is the evolutionary bridge between man and beast. And Sasquatch, enter the domain of the North American Sasquatch, towering nearly 1.5 inches over the typical brownstone Sasquatch. Sasquatch? Or Sasquatch. Fine, whatever. Tune in next week as Discovery takes you deep within the vicious web of sex, lies, and drugs that is the secret world of the North American Sasquatch. Only on Discovery After Hours.
Welcome to the 30th and most special episode ever of the Sleepy Cabin Podcast. I'm Jeff.
And why is it special, Jeff?
Yeah, why, Jeff?
Come on,
yeah. Jeff.
Yeah.
Well, like much like the finale of a TV show, one of the cast members is dying.
It's true.
It's the Bruce Wiggs. Who could kill up Tyson?
He's like broke
it?
The mic.
Well, well, the this is real, buddy.
Spoiler alert, it's me.
Every season we're going to lose a member.
Also, every member of SleepyCast is here tonight.
Yeah.
That's right.
Bruce
that
time.
Is
fine. That took us long enough.
Bruce type golf clap.
We'll try not to talk over each other.
Yep.
I can't clap.
Corey? Introduce yourself, Corey.
My name is Corey Spazkin.
They call me Z to the Dizzles.
See, I actually said my name.
That is
so
my name.
I am already on.
You get an A plus. Zach gets a Z minus.
Nice, Zach.
Dude. Yeah. I'm Zach, dude. Come on, get over it.
You get a Z.
I'm still Nile.
Oh. Good old Nile.
We're working on that, but yeah. All right.
Maybe one day. I'm Chris. Moving on.
What's your other name?
Yeah. I'm Stamper TV. How's it going?
And I am Rice Pirate Mick. Welcome to the podcast. This is a very special episode, as Whoa. Jeff said. Fuck it up. This is the final episode of the season, episode 30. We got a lot of shit to cover, so let's fucking do
it. A lot of shit to cover.
We got questions and stories and songs for y'all.
And answers. that too, Nile.
And answers to songs.
And answers to songs and answers to answers. All right, so to start it off, we do want to say, hey, thank you to our patrons who have supported us throughout all of this. We hope you love the podcast and all the other content. Thanks for all your support to all of us in general. No, it really has meant a lot.
And you know what? No one was twisting your arm to pay for anything.
Except for that dollar tier.
Yeah, no, that
if you donated a dollar, just shut up your ass.
Whatever, dude. I kissed so many people at the conventions.
Yeah, you know why?
We earned it.
Yeah, you got
it.
Sick from that.
Guys, yeah, 500 did. People well, are donating $1. They count.
I'm not going down.
It does. It absolutely counts.
From the guy that gave me tongue when the normal people
Nile?
Just
close your mouth when you kiss strangers.
It wasn't
I don't think we got tongue, Nile.
No, you did slip a bit of tongue in.
Sorry.
Listen, no, they call it a tear because everybody cries.
You tasted like marshmallows and cigarettes.
No, I love you, and we're going to move on to the next question. The first question, and this comes from Aiden Gill, and they said, how did each one of you discover Newgrounds?
Oh.
Lightning round. We've answered this before, so we're gonna blaze through it. Go, Jeff.
In 2004, I needed a job, and I searched Flash and Google, and Newgrounds came up, and then I asked Tom for a job, and he said yes, and then I worked here.
Perfect.
That's how I found out.
Hentai meet and fuck games and Mario and Sonic versus Sprite collabs.
You're McCoy said.
Go, go, go.
In 2005, I was I tried to make cartoons about a little character that was a tomato, and he'd always get sliced up at the end, and I put him on Newgrounds. So was it.
When I was 14, my friend Paul showed me a website and retired on animal babies, and I kept going on it.
Stamper?
In like 1999, I stumbled upon it because I was looking for funny animated GIFs, and then I found an animated GIF that had sound in it, and I was like, holy shit.
Wait,
it
what?
Was on Newgrounds.
Whoa, shut up. What?
No, but it was Flash.
Oh, okay, yeah.
It was what I thought was an animated GIF, but it had sound in it, and it was on Newgrounds, and that was before the automated portal even existed.
Oh, you mean like most of our cartoons that people just rip and fucking post as
GIFs? He said he saw a GIF that was a GIF
with sound, and he couldn't believe that sound was on a GIF.
Yeah.
I don't understand the concept of a dot switch.
And then Tom started adding my flashes early.
Yeah.
Before the automated shit even
You know,
existed.
Tom always says in his sleep, like while he's lying in bed, he always says he likes you the best.
Tom's a little bitch.
Yeah. All right, I found Newgrounds through...
I love Tom, I'm just kidding!
An Ego Raptor video he posted on YouTube that said, stop watching my cartoons on YouTube, go to Newgrounds because it's better. John Toomey asked, who do you hope to have on season 2 of the podcast?
Stamper?
Give it up, dude! Keep on it!
Oh my god,
that was
dude,
so
this,
quick.
The speed that was which so that fucking answer came oh, out, that so was quick. Amazing. Amazing!
Yeah.
You know, I'm just moving on. Sorry. Fuck the rest of that question. Moving on. Travis Powell asks, if an investor approached Sleepy Cabin and gave you guys $500,000 check but wanted a 5% stake in the company, would you take it?
Yes.
And what would you do with it if you did?
Take the money, shut down the company, then start a new company.
Buy a Resident Evil Man?
Call Kevin Sleepy.
It's like flipping houses. You just
start a new Patreon, keep the old one running, and just stack them up. Is that what you guys are talking about?
I'd like to think the real answer would be we'd probably do a couple animated series, we'd actually make content.
It's going
to
be like tiredhouse.com.
I think actually what I would do is I would tell him a series of questions. Catch him off guard to see if he actually was truly a Sleepy Cabin fan.
Wait, what? No, who cares if he's a fan? He just gave you a $500,000 check.
Well, if he knew about Sleepy Cabin, it's just not something he's a fan.
The other question is, are you going to take it if somebody wants 5%?
No, I would tell him.
Everybody says yes.
This is what I would say.
I was going to say, Chris, you can't spend all the money in your Resident Evil mansion.
Yeah, it's not fair. You can spend half of it.
I would really want to make
cartoons. You can build half of the mansion.
I would really spend all the
cartoons. I honestly think we would probably do a couple series.
$500,000
seems like a really arbitrary number. Like, why would anybody be like, here's $500,000 and I want 5%?
Assume he's a creepy rich kid, like he has a rich dad or something.
I would bring him into a dark room where light is shining on him, and I would ask him, does my dad fuck me?
And then start chopping off his fingers with pliers.
If he didn't give me the answer,
I'd buy a capture card and start Let's Playing and make triple that.
Yeah, exactly.
What day?
So you're basically saying with $500,000 you'd start a Minecraft Let's Play channel?
Yes.
Alright. Moving on.
He would keep all the money and then just
and make
start
more.
Let's Playing.
There you go. That's right.
Yeah.
Nathan Brown asks, not that Sleepy Cabin has been going for almost a year, how do you dashing guys feel about the growth and work of Sleepy Cabin? Has working together helped you guys grow as content producers?
No,
truthfully, working together has made me hate and resent people.
No, this group actually hates each other. We all hate each other. This is really ending. This
like,
is real.
Like, has it
this is real talk.
No, we are friends. Yeah. And we hang out.
We are friends. Everybody and Sleepy Cabin.
Like, we are friends.
Zach, are exactly like how it is portrayed
Jeff,
in the videos.
You are a good friend of mine. I value your friendship.
Tomorrow, we hang out.
Let's go eat a steak.
You're all wrong.
What was the question?
It was basically, has working together helped you guys grow as content
really
producers?
Really? No, because we've all been working together anyways.
Wait, what's a content creator?
Oh my
they
god,
make
Corey, I'm
make
smashing
the shit
face.
You've been doing for the last decade of your life, man.
You make content.
You make things and put them online.
Creator.
For
you know that's what all these fucking worthless Let's Players call themselves who play video games? They create content.
Yeah, you're a content creator.
Oh, stuff. Like,
Stuff. Literally just stuff. Like shit you throw
content.
At a wall.
If
it's
you
content.
Eat a sandwich on camera and put it on YouTube, you're a content creator.
You spit into the sink.
It really has no meaning to it.
If anything, it's I haven't made any.
It has no validity. Yeah.
So it's actually derived. I think, like, here's what's ironic is that we've got Jeff and Corey, who both have been working on a game with Tom Fulp.
Yeah,
we have Zach and Chris, who both have been working on Hellbenders. Yeah. We have Niall, who's been working on half of the ladies in Philadelphia and outside of the state. And then we've got Stamper and me, who have also been working on some other stuff. So while we have Sleepy Cabin, we chose a time to start this when everybody was working on these huge other fucking projects.
It was basically like, hey, let's start a podcast while we're all super invested in something.
We're all drowning in work.
Next, we got Jace Baker. He says...
We sent him shit today.
Yeah. We sent
yesterday.
We sent a lot of people shit today and yesterday. You're having your biography written. Which fellow Sleepy Cabin member or Jeff would you want to write it? Would you want to write it? So,
Stamper write
Shot down
again. Yeah, okay. Wait, you would write Stamper's?
So he would let Stamper write his.
Oh, you would let Stamper write yours.
The question is, who would you want to write yours?
Correct, and yes.
I would knock that shit out of the park, too.
Alright.
Great.
Corey, who would you want to write your biography?
I'd have pictures in it too for people that don't like to read.
About your life.
No, an autobiography is something you write yourself.
Yeah, that'd be you writing yourself.
What would you want somebody else to write your biography?
Like your life. If you died today and someone in Sleepy Cabin was writing a book about you, what would it be?
About your life.
Who would you
You're having your biography written.
It's a good question.
Which fellow Sleepy Cabin member?
First of all, it's kind of a big ordeal because you're asking someone to write your biography.
Okay.
Are you gonna tell us about your black friend and fucking cold corn?
No, that's important.
But why don't you just go full blown Corey and have Celery write it?
No,
move on!
Listen! Okay? Whoever would write it would have a fucking fun experience, because let me tell you something about my biography.
Zach would write it. Alright, yeah, Zach would write my biography.
I like how you just whittled that down. He's like, someone would have fun. It would be Zach.
I want Zach to do it. Yeah,
I would expect you to stretch the truth just to make it really epic on, like.
I wouldn't have to. You're a fucking maniac in the nicest way, Corey. I would have nothing to
Well, write better.
Zach, who would you have write your biography?
It's a tie. Either Jeff or Stamper. I know Jeff would just roast me. I'd be curious to see what Jeff... Zach was born ugly and stupid.
Let me tell you something, Zach. I would be diplomatic.
I think halfway through the book, you'd slip it. I think you'd slip it a lie just to see if anybody would buy it. Like, you put some weird in, like, the middle, just putting the...
Like, your dick is shaped like a question mark?
Yeah, just telling the rest of it. So I'd be curious.
You would do that, dude. You would, like, hide in stuff. Like, you had a small wiener every chance you
Whatever, I'd shit on myself, too.
Zach
would, too.
Cartoons. His penis is really gross looking. You should see it, dude. Ew, LOL. And then the rest would be like...
Like, you did amazing things.
Yeah.
Like, the climax of the story is your wiener's shaped like a question mark.
He was a pedophile. I don't know. Anyways, moving on.
I have a lot of sarcasm, maybe so much people wouldn't even know what to think.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't think you can include sarcasm in a book because people don't really understand sarcasm.
I don't know how else to...
It's like the Chinese language. It's so literal that it's like hard to be sarcastic.
If somebody asked me to write a biography, I would fill in the stuff that they didn't really know with stuff I thought.
You would write their life like a movie.
Well, they would tell
me. Oh, you would be like the frosting in between layers of cake.
Yeah. I was going to say.
You would have something...
Just making up bullshit.
Yeah, you're like, I was born and raised on a farm with my father until the spaceship came to pick us up.
So you'd lie.
No, I would.
Niall,
I would
tell who would you have write your biography?
I'd say
occasionally.
I'd say Stamper or Chris, but maybe Stamper because I don't think Chris would actually do it. I think he would do it.
Dude, I would.
In fairness, you wouldn't though, would you? Would you sit down and write like 140 pages? That's all the book.
I would have to go to fucking Galway over the fucking Irish hills and talk to your parents.
Would you do that?
Who would fucking yell at
you? You wouldn't do that. Stamper would.
I would do it if you died. Okay.
This is not.
Chris.
Well then,
Chris, who would you have write your?
I'd have Corey because he'd make shit up and he'd make everything stupid and it'd be funny.
It would be funny.
It would be funny.
Something about these assholes doing
Corey
like a real
say weird
one.
Shit like it came from the land of sand or something, and then that would be it.
It would, dude.
He was born in land of sand.
It would just be a fairy tale.
Yeah, dude. Water people and fucking all sorts of shit. Like,
there'd be like Fraggle Rock characters.
He learned about animation through the sands of seashells.
I would do that.
Stamper, who would write your biography?
Really Jeff or Niall? Fuck you, Mick!
I'd fuck you!
I'd write it very sincerely. There would be a few typos that I would miss. I apologize for that. There would be a few typos.
Because
I think I'm thorough, but I'm not as thorough as you are.
People be really keep getting
irritated. I'd make some mistakes. But it would be from the heart. Thank you,
Chris.
Yeah. I was saying Mick, but Chris, you're too nice. You're a little too flowery.
No, I wouldn't. I would always sugarcoat shit.
Chris, your biography would just be in capital letters, just no periods, because I don't like doing periods. And there would just be commas, no periods.
Just be like a long run sentence.
I need somebody. He came from the land of Sandy, Chris O'Neill.
And then, towards the middle of it, I'd be like, oh, sorry, cap lock. I'd actually type that in. Anyways.
I need somebody that has the balls to break me down to my bare matter and then explain why it happened. And just keep going up and down like this.
Know both sides of everything.
Stamper, why don't you choose me, Stamper? I got a good biography for you, Stamper.
I'm a neutral force.
Yeah. I doubt it, Zach.
I would make all the excuses for Stamper. That's the problem.
I'd make it interesting, Stamper.
I think I'd say what actually happened.
Do you want the truth or do you want lies?
No! What would I lie about?
I'm truth.
You're lies. You're bullshit. You're sass. Not real.
Does anybody know anything about you?
Corey's
dying.
I expected if Zach wrote my biography, then like there'd be some photo with like of me on the cover with like a Photoshop like American flag.
Yeah, maybe no. Be you like this. It'd be like three bridges of you looking to the side, like, looking up
as like a thinking man looking up at the sky.
Every corner of the
phone. Where everybody who knows me, the cover would be me in a coffin rotting.
No. The actual photo I have on my phone and I posted on Twitter. It was you when you passed out on the rug after one of our Twitch streams. You were literally face down in the rug with a bottle next to you. It literally looked like a crime scene. You looked fucking murdered.
Was it like fucking Chris Farley's death photo? Would it be
if somebody pulled like half of his shorts down at that point, it literally would have like some rape murder scene. I have it on my phone and I posted
it. He probably had shit around his ass. He probably did.
Was my face in pussy?
No, your face was deep down in the rug.
It was in carpet.
I get it. Fuck you.
I would actually have
either Stamper or Chris write my bios, only because Stamper knows a whole lot of fucking shit that's happened in my life in a short amount of time.
Does he?
Yeah. And Chris would write it.
Do you want science fiction?
Does anybody know anything about you?
Chris would write probably the funniest biography, only because like there'd be no punctuation and there'd be lots of misspelled words. Like then he crunks on the gronk or whatever, and he just misspell everything, just like his scripts that he sends to us.
I love writing scripts like
that. I love that you write scripts like that.
That question was like a roundabout way of saying who do you trust the most.
No, that's not true. I believe that a lot of you guys would trust me.
Question is exactly like who would you kill first in reverse. That's exactly what that question means.
I would trust you and Stamper. But if I said, look, I need one of you to, like, put a bullet in me, I would trust Stamper.
No, yeah.
Bang!
No. You chose correct.
I do it, but I might miss.
Yeah, no.
You chose correct.
You guys would hit me in, like, the liver or something.
Jeff, I'd shoot you, like, 10 times in the head to make
it. No, Jeff knows that I would stare at him or whoever made that call and be like, Stamper, why does it have to be this way?
Stamper and I have a blood pact.
Yeah. No, Stamper would just be like, all right, it has to be done. Boom. I would be like...
We're driving off a cliff like Thelma and Louise one day.
Yeah, that's right.
We held hands and all.
Thelma and Louise. All.
You're too nice. You would like shoot him in the liver and be like, I don't know if I should fully kill you yet.
No, I'd probably shoot myself before I'd shoot somebody else. All right, we got that question. Andrew Dorr asks, me and a mate are visiting the USA from Australia in a few weeks.
Oh,
are there any places in New York that you recommend we check out?
Jeff, what was that fucking ramen place we went to?
I don't know. It's like
how fast that was.
Oh, that one.
So yeah. Tasty ramen.
I don't know what the name
with
it
Tom.
Is.
I'll tell you what we need to
do. Yo, that was some of the best food great, ever. It was fucking phenomenal.
Freddy and Pepper's
ramen.
Pizza. Mwah. That no. Go to Papa Pia's Pizzeria.
Bullshit. Go to JonTron's house.
That was the one I was gonna fucking say.
Guys, the real answer is, and please, whoever's editing this. What?
Hello?
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 Hey, Tom.
Oh, are you serious? Tom Fulp.
What did you say?
Tom Fulp fucking screaming up at us, taking a piss?
Yeah, he was just saying it. He was peeing, he heard us, and then he said, hello, that's all it was.
Why is he here?
Because he wanted to pee without having to go
at
into the building.
At 8:40.
Because he wanted to see the building.
Hey, Tom!
Could I, guys?
Tom, why aren't you at home peeing?
Yeah, He had a special night with April, but I don't know why he's here.
Why is he peeing on April? That's what I want to know. You should be peeing all over his
put that, put that in the podcast. Oh my god. That is the most random ass bullshit.
Guys. I have a role answer here. Please, whoever's editing this, put patriotic music behind what I'm saying, because if
Patreon
you're
music?
Patriotic, I'm telling you this, because look, if you go to New York, you gotta see those big potholes on the ground. Those people fucking took down that day. 3,000 Americans died.
We gotta check out this place called Times Square.
Coley and I went to Ground Zero.
Yeah, the swimming pool,
Nobody was swimming. There was a little brown guy swimming around. He was being very disrespectful. He was laughing, just going, ah, you know. Anyways, this is a fun podcast story. It's really small. Mick,
you know those swimming pools is where our country was attacked.
Why would they attack a swimming pool?
Can I say this?
Yes!
There was a kiddie pool in the middle of New York, and they crashed a plane into it.
Two kids died.
Then they fell into the ugly building on top of it.
Four water floaties! Two rubber duckies were knocked down that day, my friend. It was a horrible day.
It was a travesty! America's never been the same.
Yeah, but there was no fire.
Holy shit. I'm dying.
And there was gold under the kiddie pool.
3,000 plastic pool rings died that day. Guys,
it's good we say this stuff because I want to make sure people have a zero level of respect or any expectations.
Oh, dude, it's perfect. You just close the door on everything. It's great.
Yeah. Oh, fuck.
Can I say this?
Everything with impunity here.
Mick, you saw 9/11 happen. You've never brought this up on the podcast. Mick fucking saw 9/11.
Are you serious?
Mick.
He had a front row seat to fucking 9/11 and he never brought it up before the podcast.
He was on the two towers, right on the antenna.
He was hanging on to the twin towers.
I thought I already talked about 9/11.
Truthfully, tell us what happened from your perspective.
Wow, this is going to draw
shit
out.
Your widescreen perspective.
Just be concise.
I went to the post office. I had a package to send to my mom. On my way to the post office, a guy stopped me in the street and said, "Hey, did you hear the towers got hit?" And I literally did not process it and just thought the guy was crazy. It's New York. You never know. And I was like, yeah, okay, whatever. And I went to the post office. I sent my package. No one at the post office seemed to have any kind of reaction at all. And then on my way back, there were some people that, I don't know. I guess it's kind of like, you know, things felt a little weird, but like I didn't really anticipate anything. I got to pretty much to our building, and there was a bunch of people standing outside, and they were on their phones, and everybody was trying to make phone calls, and I asked what was going on, and they said that the Twin Towers got hit, and I said, what, I mean, I guess, like, when they say it, you're just like, what does that mean? Like,
it
what
got you, hit? Like,
yeah,
what?
Like, what do you mean? Yeah, and then somebody
got
like,
hit by hackers.
Yeah, or something, and then somebody said, no, a plane flew into it. I was like, oh, shit, that's fucking crazy, and they're like, yeah, you can see it from the roof, and I was like, oh, shit. So I was like, okay. At that point, it was just like, oh, the towers
accident.
Got hit.
It was
Yeah. So I went up, and I was living with two film guys, Adrian Elzey and Ben Baker, and they were both film guys. And I went upstairs, and Ben was smoking. Adrian wasn't there. He did whatever he wanted. Ben was a big pothead back then. He still may be. Ben Baker, Lee. Anyways, I woke him up, and I said, hey, dude, I heard the towers got hit, and you can see it from the roof. We should go up. And he's like, what are you talking about? Anyways, he woke up and he brought his camera up and we went up and all the people in our building, which we very rarely saw. It was a converted warehouse, textile factory, which was then turned into a bunch of lofts. 248 McKibben Street. Anyone in New York who knows that, it's there. Anyways, it's off the Montrose stop. And we went up to the roof and there was just everybody. Everybody was up on the roof of the building, and they all had their phones out, and everyone was trying to make phone calls, and no one could get through to anything. But what was really creepy is that you're across the river, so you can actually look across into Manhattan, and you could just see, like, one of the towers, and there's, like, smoke coming out of it, and it was pretty creepy.
The iconic image.
Yeah, well, it was one of the iconic images. It was both of them were still standing at the time.
Yeah.
And only one was hit at this point, am I correct?
Yeah, only one was hit.
Oh, you got there before the second one was hit.
Yeah. Wow. So everyone had said the first one hit, and then by that time I got home and went upstairs and we saw it. And then while we were up there, somebody brought up a television because none of our shit was fucking working. No one could make phone calls and all that kind of shit.
All the lines were like...
I believe, I was telling Stamper this earlier, was that the cellular tower was on top of... the Twin Towers. I believe that was the case.
This was 2001 where people still had cell phones, but it wasn't like a huge thing.
A lot of people had them at that point. Yeah, a lot of people had them at that point.
But it wasn't as accessible.
We all had that flip shit. There was no, like, smartphones.
Yeah, there's, like, flip Nokia.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Well, you know.
Yeah, so, but anyways, we were up there, and no one could make phone calls, and one of the towers was hit. Ben brought up his camera, and someone brought up a television, an antenna television, and they had the local news going on, which was interesting because, like, pixel for pixel, what you saw on the horizon versus what you saw, on the actual television was pretty much relative. And then the second one, well, basically everything after the first one hit. So we saw the first tower go down. We also saw the second one hit. And when all that was happening, I just remember everyone trying to call people. And Stamper and I were actually talking about, like, post-apocalyptic movies where, like, how do people feel like the world is ending? And we always see, like, you know, people hanging from a lamppost or people shooting themselves or whatever. But the truth is, the way it really fucking hits you is when your cell phone...
You try to fucking call someone.
Yeah, when you try to call someone or your internet doesn't work.
And they're not in your phone book.
Because, like, all of a sudden, you can't contact anybody. You feel...
isolated.
Isolated. Like, here I was with, like,
even with
60
a pay
people.
Phone, nobody remembers phone numbers anymore.
Oh, yeah. Even if you had the phone, you couldn't call anybody.
Yeah.
But it's like, here you are trying to call, like, your parents or whatever to let them know you're all right or whatever.
Yeah.
And, like, you don't have cell service. You don't have internet. You don't have any of this fucking shit. There's no better way to make people feel isolated than take away that.
Because it's weird because it takes down your communication from the world down to a block.
And you're so used
to
it.
Down to the top
you
of
can't
room.
Tweet it. You can't Facebook it. You can't call somebody. You can't text somebody. You're literally
you're
just
to
like
yourself. Look
who's
your resources.
Yeah. Who's next to me?
If
and
you
we're
had
all
it,
sharing
would you be
experience?
Like the second tower just went down? LOL.
Yeah. No, you'd probably take a photo and put it on Instagram, add a filter or something.
And then like put like a filter.
Oh yeah. No, that would.
Make it. I have to ask this because I'm genuinely curious. I remember it specifically at that time. The initial news was like, if you listen to a lot of the radio broadcast or Howard Stern or fucking anybody who was CNN or whatever was going on at that point.
Oh, yeah,
initially,
yeah.
Everybody thought it was an accident. And what point did it dawn on you?
When the second tower got hit, everybody knew. And not only that, but we had, like I said, we had the TV up there.
Yeah.
And once the second tower
people
got hit...
immediately... I mean, how immediate was it before you went, okay?
It was fairly clear, but it wasn't exactly crystallized until...
The Pentagon?
Yeah. So what happened was is that we were looking at a screen that had the Twin Towers hit, and then all of a sudden, the screen on the news went split screen, and they showed the Pentagon... As soon as we saw the Pentagon with a plane hitting the side of it, everybody on the roof was like, fuck.
Yeah.
Half the roof cleared out and ran down and got water. It was like, as soon as that fucking happened, there was no fucking question. And at that point, I have a tape somewhere in my boxes. It's called Black Tuesday. And it's just a cassette tape where I just popped it into one of our stereos and I pressed record as the news was playing.
And it was just, what is it, you reacting to it?
No, not me at all.
Oh, you recorded
I just recorded like radio stations.
Okay.
So it was like your favorite rock band radio station press record during 9/11 in New York. And it was like all of these guys.
Dude,
like,
no,
just, like,
that was
exactly the fuck
that
out.
Was what everything was. I was
everything
on,
was dedicated to it.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I remember I was sleeping on the couch and my dad called me. And he said, turn on the TV.
Yeah.
I said, okay, what station? He said, it doesn't matter.
It's
and I was like, oh my God.
Yeah, even in Ireland.
I've heard that story several times. My mom, the same thing. My aunt called her and said, turn on this. What's it? Doesn't matter. It was everywhere. Even it was also in the country.
When somebody
that's
says it doesn't matter,
that's
you
bad.
Know
something
wake up.
Happened.
Yeah.
Yeah, like my mom, like I lived in Ireland, in Galway in Ireland, some remote area. And my mom was like, I remember it happened. My mom kept like, she was on the phone. She's like, is it the end of the world? Is it the end of the world? This
well,
is
for
fucking
some context.
In
and you're in Ireland.
My parents bought a bunch of fucking pot noodles because they thought we'd have to hide underground.
Oh shit.
For context.
And he's in Ireland too.
Wait, your parents bought pot noodles for you to hide underground in Ireland?
Yep.
Because of what was happening in
I
water.
I thought they were buying them to
they
send
literally
us.
Thought, they thought the whole world was going to be World War III the next day.
Was
gonna
be
that was actually, that was actually the biggest concern.
Because look, I mean, at this point,
I was playing
if you think of the context, 2001, the U.S. is like the biggest military power in the world. It still is. But the Pentagon got hit. Today, that's unimaginable, but the fucking Pentagon got hit.
It was weird when it started out, though, because when I was listening to Stern Live, when they said the plane hit
the
building.
Yeah, you said you were actually listening to
it. Because of the vastness of the building, they thought it was a small plane that hit the,
right.
the tower.
Right, and that was initially what was said.
They were almost laughing about it.
You listened to that Howard Stern thing live? Yeah. I watched it recently on YouTube, like, 2 days ago.
Stuttering John came in the studio, and he's almost... Like they're almost like taking it lightly. Oh, a little plane hit
the building.
And I think around the time the second tower gets hit, they still go and tell it's like, under attack. He's like,
what do you think, Robert? She's like, oh, that's nasty.
what's crazy is about that day.
Fucking Artie's like,
not to dwell on this much, but what's crazy about that day is if you listen to all those broadcasts, it's like, okay, things got worse continually. First tower gets hit, second tower gets hit. I think Pentagon get hit, first tower collapses, second tower collapses. It was like things every like hour were happening worse and worse.
I was driving home when they mentioned the Pentagon thing, and I'm like, man, my stomach was in knots. I'm like, Jesus.
Well, that wasn't even the last one. Then they did mention that thing out in, where was it, Oklahoma or Ohio?
Which place?
That one plane that went down.
That was here, dude. That was fucking Pennsylvania, dude.
Oh, was it Pennsylvania?
It was PA. Apparently, they say it was...
being an emotional wreck.
They say that Pennsylvania plane was meant for the White House or meant for...
it was on its way, but then they brought it down.
But yeah, well, yeah, the people fucking...
You gotta admit, though, they did a good job. They orchestrated that pretty well. They killed a lot of people.
Yeah.
Anyways, next question.
Yeah, Hitler did a good job, too, right?
Yeah, not bad.
Right.
So, the Pentagon got hit? I actually didn't know
that.
It's the night. It's 9/11, dude.
Yo, this isn't the politics hour.
Move on,
Corey. Like that's really offensive because I lost a friend in 9/11.
All right. Question is what? And just to
answer, the question, a really good place to eat in New York is Subway. Great.
Okay. No. Actually,
McDonald's, dude. Hold on. They got crazy fries, dude.
Dude, places. If you want good Chinese food, there's two places. You either go to Sammy's, and that's on 6th. That's the America, the Avenue of America.
He's not talking about restaurants. He was just talking about places.
Oh, yeah, places to visit New York.
Yeah, but
and then
places,
the other place
though,
is Flushing, where they have awesome Chinese and dim sum. It is an awesome place to have Chinese food. It is.
Of course, you're going to say the Chinese food, but pizza is what people really go to New York for. Freddy and Peppers.
You know what? Honestly,
is the best place.
Honestly,
to get
I got
to
agree with Niall.
Do I have to crack on New York pizza one more time?
Yeah, and none of y'all ever went to fucking Flushing. Suck dick.
I had pizza in New York. Flushing.
Don't cross the street. Don't
Jake everyone... Duncan. Jake Duncan asks, Stamper, any updates on new music? Fat Refund was amazing. Can't wait for more noises from your vocal
cords. Oh! Do I have some surprises for you, my friend?
Awesome. Great answer. Trevor Wood asks, do you guys ever dive into some of the more expansive metal genres?
Oh!
Such as
do I have
black
some answers
metal,
for you, my friend?
He does.
Yeah, Dark Fortress, folk metal... Corpiclani and or pirate metal Aelstorm.
You know what? Yeah, let me reverse this question and say, recommend us some bands.
Yeah, all right, there we go. Next one.
Immediately.
Yeah, Trevor Wood.
Because that sounds very interesting.
Just, I think he did by sending those examples. We'll check them out. Thanks, Trevor.
Thanks,
next,
Trevor.
Wrinkly Wiener Kenneth asks.
Wrinkly Wiener, I know him.
If you could, A, travel back in time and change something you regret doing, not doing, or B, travel to the future and see how your life will be at any given time, which would you choose?
I can't make any sense of that question.
Can you simplify that a little bit?
All right. Would you rather go back and change something or go in the future and see something?
This is what Zach said. Zach had a really good point. I would rather see to the point where I die.
I'd see the day I die. I'd see how old I get.
The day I died.
Yeah, but if you knew,
are you kidding me?
Yeah,
I don't see the day you die.
I want to see if I made a mistake at any point and how I can fix it.
You can't mess with temporal mechanics like this.
Listen,
shut up, Doc Brown.
Listen, if there's time travel involved, the fucking rule book is ripped apart and thrown out the door.
No, are you that worried about the day you die that you have to go see it because you're afraid?
I never said I was worried. I said I was curious. On the day I die, so
I don't care.
Can see it and maybe try to prevent it. Because if I die from old age,
hold on,
whatever.
That's more coin I dip, bro. I want to prevent it. I want to see my. Okay, do I die at 30? Do I die at 80?
I don't want to die.
That's so fucking selfish.
Listen,
guys.
I don't want to see that I die at 20.
You guys are so paranoid and petrified. It's fucking hilarious.
Oh, what would you do? What would you do?
I would go back.
No, wait. What would you do, Stan?
What
would
you
do,
Stan? What the first time you fucking jerked off? Shut your little baby self up!
All of you, shut the fuck up.
Second question is, NFA, what would you change?
Oh, there's got to be change involved if you go to the past.
You know what I would change? the question.
Hold on. Jeff, what's your answer?
I don't know.
Oh, come
on. I was
going
to say something about traveling back in time and seeing how many of you I could prevent from being born, but that's it.
Jeff is the only person I genuinely asked this to.
Jeff, you're saying
if
that.
If you went back in time, if you could go, if you could go into the future and you could see how you died.
What are you eating, Nick?
My trail mix? My fucking trail mix?
I'm eating it all, by the way. If you went into the future and you could see how you died.
And now it's going right to his tits. I don't even care.
Would you change it? Let's say you saw yourself die tragically.
It's inevitable. It's going to be a terrible death.
What if it's
no,
like
I'm just saying, if you saw it, let's say in the future you saw that you somehow slipped in the bathtub and broke your head at this one date.
Yeah.
Yo, what is this, final destination?
Would you do anything to prevent it, or would you just be like, oh, that's it?
I don't want to die terribly.
Hey, my point, I'm a pussy for wanting to change how my fucking outcome, but I die like
nobody said that, Corey.
He did not say that. He didn't say that.
If you know you're going to die terribly, say I slip in the bathtub and die when I'm 80.
You know what I'm talking about.
I come back
if
this time.
I saw what I
All right, so you saw how you died. It was tragic. Do you want to change that?
I don't care. Next question.
Nick, I just realized one of us are going to, like, in this room, are going to die first.
Yeah.
Who do you think it would be?
Maybe
one of us get hit by a train tomorrow.
Stamper or Corey?
Oh, no.
What, Corey?
Why me when I'm sucking on power tools at night?
I don't know. I don't know. Like, either... Stamper is either gonna like I don't know what he's gonna do. He might do something.
He's on board.
He'll get really drunk late at night and go for a late night drive and run into somebody, or Corey's gonna like walk into oncoming traffic.
Yeah, you know me.
See, that's where you're wrong,
Nick. I'm like, hold on, I need to clear the earwax out of my ear, so I take a fucking screwdriver and stick it in and hope I get everything.
I never said that.
That's what you use tools for?
No, I'm assuming you guys are calling me mouth breathing retarded.
Nobody said that!
I'm assuming that I died from someone who's practically dead now.
Cole, you like
fuck you!
No, dude, it's always reversed. Like, you know the dude that, like, he treats his body like shit for years? He always lives to be, like, 89.
That's right.
Dude, Chloe's like one of those.
And then all the paranoid people that make sure they have they count their macros and they worry about calories. And
you know what's weird?
They die at, like, 36.
You get a fucking aneurysm.
No, I hear stories about people like George Burns who live until, like, fucking 90.
98.
Smoking a cigar, 98, who smoke cigars and drink a fucking margarita or a fucking martini until the day they die every day. And then I hear about people who are 35 who die of lung cancer, who jog every day, who've never smoked a fucking cigarette.
It's genetics, a lot of it is.
I think a lot of it is genetics.
At fucking 30 from lung cancer.
I can't even imagine Corey dying. I imagine, like, Corey could be hit by a bus, every day the bus would die, but Corey would...
I'm saying Corey's like one of those fucking babies from, like, the Warner Bros. cartoons where he's, like, walking across the shit and just walking through traffic.
Being hurt.
I'm going to turn into I will be the first T1. 100 million.
No, I just imagine Corey turning into the next Flash version that we actually want to use. Well, and all of a sudden, it's just like this AI.
Imagine Corey's a fucking Terminator.
Yeah. I'd be like,
what'd you say?
I'd be like, give me all your cereal box with toys inside of you.
Are you still a car?
Cereal box?
Give me all your cereal
Did
box.
Did they ever have Terminator cereal? I know for a fact.
Probably.
They had Batman cereal, they had Bill and Ted cereal. They had Ninja Turtle cereal, they had...
It's funny, too, because Terminator 2 was an R-rated movie, and they're just selling toys and cereal.
They were. And definitely lunchboxes, for sure.
Well, you know what's another really silly question about that?
Back in the day, nobody really gave a shit if kids watched rated R movies.
RoboCop was fucking R. RoboCop was super R. That was...
Do you remember when you did get toys and cereal?
What?
And you would get toys like...
Of course.
You get toys like plastic.
And your parents were like, you're not buying that box of cereal just because you're going to get to the bottom and get that toy.
No, I mean, like, the toy is like a plastic spoon. Or like a little bowl or something.
I used to
like
buy Cracker Jacks for the...
Cracker Jacks, absolutely.
They actually came with...
They're like American Kinder Eggs. They were like the ones that came with like the fun toy.
They were fun.
They came with like stickers or decals or...
There was little things that you snap together,
sometimes,
like four or five parts.
Yeah.
And you know what's weird about RoboCop?
What?
I remember watching it with... I was at my friend's house and he had three kids and they were like 12, 10, and 8.
Yeah.
And I was like, go into the fucking living room and just watch a movie. And they put on RoboCop. And I didn't even think anything because I was trying to work.
Yeah.
And they all watched RoboCop and they thought that it was a fucking amazing movie. They loved it. Their mom came home and fucking chewed me out and shit because dudes were getting blown apart. But what was weird about that was I watched RoboCop really late in life. I never really saw it
as a kid.
I saw a couple of pieces of it.
Oh, I saw.
But when I was old older, I watched it for the first time and it made me sick. I was like, Jesus Christ,
it's
dude,
fucking
this
brutal.
Movie is,
that's one thing my parents, brutal, they let me watch.
But it was a weird split difference where, like, I'd watched tons of rated R movies, but then I finally watched RoboCop later and I was like, fuck, what did I
see,
do?
See, there's a difference between rated R movies and other rated R movies, because I hear so many stories of, my mom left me at home by myself to watch Poltergeist. Or fucking Freddy Krueger, or
well, RoboCop is different. RoboCop is fucking real. It's like hookers and
that's true.
It's brutal.
Man, we ran RoboCop the second it came out on tape. It was the family movie night.
was it
RoboCop? I was in like fifth grade.
This explains a lot.
And then
Jeff.
In like the first 5 minutes, the dude's getting blown apart, and they're like, no.
It wasn't the goriest version. They released that afterward. But
this sucks, but you can't buy that anywhere on DVD. Pretty much, they don't sell it anywhere. You have it on DVD?
Yeah.
Really? Would you
suck
get it?
On that, Zach? You little
Jeff.
So long.
I got it. It was at some convention. They were selling bootleg movies.
Oh my god.
I tried it on eBay. And
all I remember is scene in the boardroom where the
that's the scene where you know if it's
he's shooting the guy for like 5 minutes.
I know, dude. That's like jars of spaghetti sauce just exploding.
Yeah, he's just jazzing in the fucking pudding. It's like unbelievable.
He says it's a fucking malfunction. Was he a glitch?
So they don't sell that.
No, you can't.
Zach, you need to
it's the most
A, meet more black
movie.
People, and B,
really?
Carry more money in your pocket.
Yeah, what?
Excuse me?
Speaking,
and C, walk around the city streets
speaking,
where there's
someone speaking
get the fucking
of
AC on.
Black people, Harwin A asks, when do you think the Muslims will finally take over Europe?
5 years. Look at France.
No, I give it 30 years.
Muslims?
No, I'd say about 10.
Sorry, don't look. I don't think France is fair. You got to look at all of Europe.
Well, France,
I think
France
and England, I think, will probably be taken over in about 10. But
Germany and all those.
Yeah, well, no, actually, Germany, no way, dude.
They have the fucking what's it called, Pedigo or whatever, Pagino, whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
They have groups specifically dedicated to that now, I think.
All right. So Europe's done. All right. Next, Ryan Crowley asks, at some point, have you ever contemplated giving up your trades because of a struggle to find creative motivation?
Not motivation.
No. Have you ever thought of giving up your creative trade because you were struggling in your motivation?
No, no. I never lose motivation.
I mean, maybe a lack of early on, maybe like, no, but no, it never deterred me.
Answer is no.
Yeah, no.
We're not just gonna bail on it and go run and do something else.
That's not the question he was asking.
That is the question.
You need to ask it from his point of view. Like, maybe he's feeling that. That's why he asked you.
Yeah, no, I agree. I suffer from real bad ADD, and like ever since I moved to America, I haven't been on meds or anything, and it's been really hard for me to actually focus on anything. Like, and it's really tough because, like, you know, I'm living with these guys who are really creative and shit, and I can't like actually just like focus on one thing. And you know, I could help you guys could like actually guide me in ways. Wait, yeah, you did.
Well, I didn't.
Oh, really?
I had no idea this was a thing.
Oh no, this is a real thing. No, And so, like, it's really hard for me to actually get motivation and stuff because I just can't think of, like, one thing for more than 5 seconds.
A lot of people have this problem.
And yeah, see, that's the thing. You can't beat yourself up ever, but I feel like everybody has problems, especially when it comes to creative shit.
Yeah.
So you can't, like, everybody feels bad about everything they do, and it's always, like, this constant
struggle.
Well,
and I'll say
struggle.
This, too. Maybe if you're not, maybe if you, you know, everyone has a weak spot with creativity, so maybe you're really good at creating.
Oh, that's true, yeah.
So maybe you're super good at thinking of ideas, but maybe you're not good at executing them.
That's so true.
So everyone has a soft spot. So maybe you see people who seem like we're creative
and funny.
We all have weak spots, whether it's like timing or like getting stuff out on time,
yeah,
or getting stuff done or doing long projects or whatever. If you feel stressed out, it's easy to get burnt out. And if you feel stressed out and overwhelmed, actually step away. You're not weak or whatever. You're gonna be weak if you fucking burn yourself out. You can't work for 2 weeks.
I'll say this. If you're sitting at home beating yourself up every day because you feel like you're not a good voice actor, if day after day, then maybe you shouldn't be a voice actor. Maybe you could keep doing it, but maybe you were meant for something else.
Yeah
explore
it's
all
not
areas.
To say that you, why pigeonhole yourself? There's no reason to pigeonhole yourself into a specific career. The world has changed, and the world constantly changed.
By the way, the world is it's certainly now is the time where you can change. It allows you to.
Yeah.
Like, none of us are singularly voice actors or singularly. I mean, Jeff, you're a voice actor, game designer, animator, core. You're a fucking. You're
it is
insane.
Weird.
You don't have to point at a star and say I'm going to be a web designer for the rest of my life and lock yourself into this.
I will say it's weird though. This is kind of on topic, but when you get to a certain age, you sort of realize there's certain professions it's just impossible. Like, I can't be a police officer now. I can't fly fighter jets now. Just saying.
You could.
That's the thing, Jeff. Like,
I can't.
You could.
I probably can't.
See, no, I got see, that could, feeling when I found out there was, like, 12-year-old golfers that were getting better scores than Tiger Woods, and I was like, wow.
I think it's all
you.
You could definitely be a police officer because most of them are douchebags and it's pretty easy to get in there, right?
Saying, you'd be the best. You'd be the most in-shape police officer.
You shouldn't be a fighter pilot, though, because your eyesight is bad.
Yeah, my eyesight stinks, but I'm just saying, like, things people get into in, like, their early 20s and train hard, and you're just like, I don't know. It's just, you sort of cross that bridge. You're just like, fuck that.
But this is the transitional generational period where you don't have to train hard for one specific walk of life.
Yeah, you just got to break your ass for all of them.
Some people still do stand-up when they're still
comedy. You're funny and creative. You can do any number of things.
Yeah. That also opens up the other door where people think they are.
Yeah.
And it's not working out very well.
With too much confidence out there that are worthless.
You know what? And there's people with too much confidence that actually get really successful based on them just being confident.
Like, if you're motivated and confident, you don't need talent.
No, but that's actually correct.
But Jeff, like, the thing with me is that I vowed never to work in retail or fast food ever again. I would rather be homeless and, like, okay, jokes.
Dude, I'm the same way.
I would rather not have a job than just not work, like, work in any of those kinds.
Apparently,
of
that's all.
First, you need your ADD medicine. And then you need to start working on stuff.
I don't know how to do it.
Yo, Niall, hit me up. I got the hookup.
Speaking of ADD, Dude Saab asks, for those of you who use Manga Studio 5, wait, who here uses Manga Studio 5?
Me, Chris, Zach.
I can't remember who uses it exactly. Do you prefer to use the tools that are more like inks, markers, and pens, or do you prefer tools that are more like paint?
Well, it's different for everything. You use the ink pens for like line work, and you use the like watercolor pens for shading. You
know, perfect answer. What about you, Chris?
You know what? That's a girl program. Let's talk about something else.
All right.
Let's talk about
whatever flash lines.
Yeah, that's Jaggy. Flash lines, Jeff.
Riley, Paul.
Whatever Ed and Eddie lines.
All right, everybody relax.
To be fair. Hey, I use flash lines, and they're shit.
Bing.
No, to be fair,
that's what I do.
Jeff's flash lines are really good.
Jeff's in the section of the room.
Did you say flash lines?
It's because you used the pen tool.
To that beast.
Yeah. All right. Riley Paul asks, what's the cringiest you've ever found on the internet?
The cringiest? What does that mean?
Man, me and Niall, we're going to have a fucking...
Oh, God.
Field
well, I helped found the Cringe channel, which was...
That's how me and you met.
Yeah, well, actually, me and Chris met that way. It was... did a website where we just stole videos that were cringy and uploaded them onto it. And then, like, the guy I worked with,
Wait, you and Chris both did
this? No,
it was just me.
You're, like, funny junk.
But Chris liked it.
But, like, less popular.
No, but it wasn't, like,
He insulted the fucking century. Jesus Christ, that was brutal.
Yeah, dude, that was brutal.
You're like a worse funny junk.
Funny junk gets less traffic.
God damn, maybe that was...
Like, that cut a little deep, but at the same time,
I thought it was pretty fucking true, but okay, whatever.
Less traffic.
Wait, Nick, wait, it's true?
I'm here.
No, it's true. It is true. I'm just kidding. I was just like slagging Mick. But what the thing that happened was I started this YouTube channel called Master Spaghetti. I got like 60,000 like subscribers or something. I was like nuts at the time. Then this other guy called he kind of ripped me off. He stole my videos, but my videos were stolen anyway. They were called like I just stole them from, like, cringy videos because I used to look them up at the time, and we called it Cringe Channel. And
now, what was your definition of a cringy video?
Just a video where it's like really hard to watch. You need to pause it halfway through to be like, oh my god.
Wait, are you talking about the cringiest stuff we've ever done?
And then after that, Reddit.
What's the cringiest thing you saw on the internet?
Yeah. Then after that, Reddit Cringe was made, or Cringe, and. Yeah, the rest
so
is
why
like,
did you embrace the suffering of other human beings?
At the time, no one else did that.
It's
and,
not all about people suffering. It's just about people uploading videos of their own. Like a lot of people just made videos of themselves and made asses of themselves. It was their choice to put
it. It was their choice to upload
really
it. However, I do feel
but the
bad about
public backlash is their suffering.
I know.
And you contribute to that, so it's all human suffering.
Or you're promoting.
Yeah, you gotta think of it both ways.
I do feel, but no, the promoting thing was not something that I.
You know what? I think of it as bully, and bully.
I didn't do shit. I watched it. That's all I did.
No, it's bully. It is bully, and that's why I didn't want to monetize it.
All I did
was watch it. But then the guy who ran it with me wanted to
monetize it. You watch cringy shit.
The most cringiest thing I ever saw on the internet is any video where I actually show myself as like a anytime I do like my lip spank things or any kind of like update video where it's me.
Truthfully,
absolutely. I'm not fucking around. Like, I literally get, those are the videos I cannot watch.
Well, I can't listen to podcasts with me in them, so I guess I do.
Yeah,
the most cringy shit I have ever seen is
my videos too.
Yeah, Rice.
Yep,
anything
yep,
by
yep,
Rice Pirate. Yep, anything by
that's my
Rice Pirate
too.
Mick.
That's my, fuck you.
You look it up as a little ball of rice.
Yep,
pirate.
Yep,
cartoons.
Stamper,
videos.
You are absolutely 100% correct.
My real answer.
Listen,
is,
also you're not gonna live past next week, so there you go.
Well, I still got a week.
Enjoy it.
I saw a video where it was like a dude with like these fucking like 90s glasses. Like the, like,
I'm tired of you talking about me.
I love
me.
That video.
No, we're done. We're done with
like, this guy like Jeffrey Dahmer glasses. He had this mustache, and he basically.
You mean like the sunglasses that you normally wear?
No,
the 90s
cool
glasses.
Nice horny faggot. Anyways, this guy called over like a realtor.
Damn, dude.
This guy called over like this chick to look at his house. And he invites her in. He has like a video camera the whole time.
Yeah.
And he's like,
I found that originally.
Yeah, he's like so. He keeps like asking her. He's like basically. He's dragging her along.
Oh my god, I was one of the original finders of this video.
He has no intention, absolutely no intention of actually buying the house or looking at it.
Okay, so this guy looks like a 90s serial rapist. And what he does is he goes to like realtors that are women and he tries to hit on them and carry on, Zach.
Yeah, so essentially like he makes like an Auschwitz joke at one point and he's kinda nervously laughing because this guy is a fucking like camcorder.
So who's filming it?
Himself.
He filmed this.
Essentially,
so how do you know what he looks like if
he's filming himself, he turns it on himself.
But, wow, that is doubly cringy.
But the reason he recorded this to begin with is because he thought he was picking up the woman. And by the way, at the very end, he lies about having a wife. He's like, oh yeah, this would be a good place for my wife and I. And at the very end, he's like, yeah, I don't really have a wife. And she's like, oh, okay, let's, She gets super visibly uncomfortable.
Yeah.
I had to pause it probably 30 times. I couldn't watch all of it.
I actually originally found that video. That's
probably the worst one. Try to look it up. I don't know what it's called.
That's why it's kind of shocking.
Why do you go out of your way to watch it?
I think a lot of it is to do with relatability.
Yeah.
Yeah, because like, you feel like you're that guy as well.
Yeah, like, there's videos where I'd be watching it, like, where a kid would upload himself to, like, YouTube when he's 13.
Yeah.
He'll make a complete ass of himself.
Okay, and, we'll say and Eye of the Spider.
Yeah,
like,
you can sit there and be, like, I looked like that kid. I could have been that kid.
See,
I had the internet years before.
Dude, oh, that is such horseshit.
It's not horseshit.
Dude, people watch cringe videos to say, look at what that asshole did. I'm so much
well,
better.
Well, yeah, that's
than he
like
is.
Definitely
look
a lot of it.
On,
but I'm saying that.
But he's saying it's the I dodged that bullet.
Yeah, there's a lot of. There's seriously.
I could have easily.
There's so
have been
many
that
things
dude.
On my
I
mean, like, that easily could have been me. Comedy bombing videos are funny because the comedians are usually assholes and they deserve it. And you're like, yeah.
You watch them implode.
A lot of those a lot of those videos are satisfying because they're making asses of themselves.
I want to wipe the screen. Of that, man. God.
What?
It's hard, yeah, it's just really hard. I guess that's the cringe part. It's hard for me to watch.
Yeah.
But
no, but a lot of the time,
I'll say this too, like, cringe is like an evolved trait for sympathy.
Yeah.
No, it is the ultimate, absolutely.
That is the biggest crock of shit.
No! The reason why
you sympathy?
No!
Are you kidding
if
me?
You cringe, it's because you are sympathizing with that situation.
That's all it is.
That has nothing to do with the fact that you want to watch it.
I actually agree with that.
I will say, no, I will say, listen, this is 100% serious. I feel like the time where I cannot watch something is when someone else is really uncomfortable in the position. Like, this, like if some fucking creepy autistic is bothering someone who clearly isn't interested, that makes me uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because that person's like, get the fuck away from me, but he's just, this idiot doesn't see any social cues.
You guys have no problem watching these videos while I'm standing.
I don't, you know what, I don't mind seeing an autistic implode on himself, but I do mind when said autistic is imploding on someone who doesn't want to see it. Because
I don't know
then,
what you're talking about.
Look, he's this is another factor.
He's saying he doesn't mind the video where it's just like Chris Channel Otis.
Yeah.
He's saying the videos where
it's
at McDonald's like screaming
at
somebody.
Yeah, if some creepy like someone like with like toys and stuff went up and was like, I really think you're pretty and want to give this to you. And the person's like, get the fuck away from me. That makes me uncomfortable.
Another thing is,
I don't laugh at that
Corey,
stuff. I turn that
off. Like the first time you watch like Chris Chan, that is the first, like that, you'll cringe the first time, right?
But he's by himself.
No, I know, right? But you'll cringe the first time, but then you'll watch the next thing he uploads because he uploads like 500 videos, right? So you'll cringe for every video because it's always new.
But you'll be entranced.
But then the next time you watch it, you've already seen it, so you don't cringe anymore. Now you're a fan, so you kind of just watch it to watch
somehow
it again.
Chris Chan transcends this to me. I don't know why, but...
No, he's the same. You're guilty of that, too. He's cringe still.
I'm not a fan of this stuff, but
the,
Chris
what
Chan
you feel towards Chris Chan
to
is what everyone else feels
Chris
towards
Chan
other
evolved
psychos.
Into this, like...
It's the same feeling, that satisfaction you get. The satisfaction
genius.
You get from Chris Chan is what other people feel.
Right.
It extends further.
Okay.
So that's I think cringe is one of those definitions that's so up in the
speaking
air.
Speaking of cringe, Jesus Christ, shut the fuck up. Let's get to our next
question. Let's get to our cringy ass.
Yeah.
We didn't even answer.
Can I bookend this by saying, I do think that some videos go super overboard and do get.
Totally.
That's my drink. What are you doing?
Yes.
This is my drink.
Okay. Like that.
Wait, sorry, that was your last statement?
No, 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 sorry. So, Governor Redcup, anyway, sorry. Yeah, Chris Chan, on one end you have Chris Chan, the other end you have people uploading like Kill Yourself comments to some fat guy who's just doing movie reviews or something.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and there's a huge
I don't mind seeing someone, okay, here's another example. One last example, but I don't mind if somebody's clearly trying. If you see someone who's put their heart into everything, and if it's a little cringy, you can still look past it because at least in their eyes, they're actually like...
Like, Chris Chan tries. He really means what he's doing.
Another thing about Chris Chan...
That is such horseshit. You know you take that video, link it to all your friends,
that's
and
not
look
true.
No. Fucking loser.
That's not true at all.
Yes, it is.
No, it isn't. There's a gray area between somebody who is clearly out of their fucking mind and somebody who is actually...
Corey,
like,
how do you even know who's out of their fucking mind?
It's not just black and white.
Are you kidding me? I fucking... harbored on the concept of autism. Chris Chan was my life for 4 fucking years. You think I can't tell the difference between an autistic who's imploding on himself?
He harbors on...
Dude, that is amazing.
That is exactly what I'm talking about.
That's
Corey.
Amazing.
No, but you guys are forgetting that Chris Chan's really mean.
Corey, you proved yourself.
What? You guys are forgetting that he's like... Corey.
That is the most poetic way of saying where you stand, by the
way,
Corey. Chris
Chan, okay, Chris Chan is racist.
He deserves it. He's
homophobic. A fucking douchebag.
Well, no, wait. Okay, one, he was
so
badly.
Why pick on him? He's clear.
Nobody picks
you're
on him.
You're just
We're watching it. It's interesting.
Step.
Okay.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Let me say something.
If you were at a store, you saw something.
You don't think what you guys have been doing for years is picking on somebody?
I will admit.
How are you picking on
him?
Anyone, please tell me how.
This is Stamper.
I will admit that I did pick on him back then, and I do feel remorse for what I've done. But I will also admit that now seeing the error of my ways, I can also appreciate the fact that he's made charming content.
Corey, that's
actually
a really nice
Stamper. Can I make this point?
No, shut up! I'll give you a hoof.
Shut up! If you were
fucking, nice varsity jacket, Zach.
If you were at McDonald's,
nice varsity jacket, Chris.
What?
If you were at McDonald's, you saw somebody screaming, going, "I ordered pickles on my hamburger, you motherfucker!" You'd sit there and watch. You'd laugh at
you.
I would turn up immediately. No, no. If you actually at the
why
person,
would
you
I
saw it in person?
Oh,
in person,
I'd walk out.
In person, you would fucking sit there
I'd
and watch.
Jeff would walk out.
No, seriously.
I think there's a difference.
No.
By the way,
jokes aside, judging my character, how long you've known me, you think I would sit in McDonald's and laugh at somebody
just,
like that?
Just watch him. You'd be like,
you would at least sit there in interest. You would.
In interest. You fucking wouldn't. You know it. Would you?
I wouldn't watch it for entertainment. I would be really
you're
upset.
You're fascinated.
Stamper.
If someone farted
really loud and laughed, like, you would notice.
I'd be really uncomfortable.
He does that every day.
And I'd be still hoping that it's
pointing at me for it.
My point is,
you said about humor that humor, all it is something new. So when you see something new, like a guy walking into a McDonald's and puking all over himself and falling the puke and doing like a snow angel, like that would make you laugh because it's new
it's
and you've never seen it before.
It's captivating.
No, the theory behind humor is something that you haven't seen before.
That's what I'm saying.
I've seen a lot of that. You've never seen a crazy person before. You see, you are all fucking teenagers.
They do new things.
And every time you see somebody,
I have never
like,
seen
like
a
this,
man worse than a two medallion.
Listen,
up until that point.
Listen, that's true. You
no, you are right
people,
though. That's what's annoying
but
right now. You don't see
I'll agree with your point that if there's a
difference,
I don't agree that you should fucking bother these people. I don't agree that you should laugh at these people.
No.
If it's a fucking freak show,
you should laugh at these people if it's Chris Chan. However, Stamper is right in the fact that like it's stuff that
watching
you've seen
somebody
before.
out of pure fascination
it is
fucking being baffled.
I do agree that laughing and pointing and
Tom asks if you could set one word in the English language on fire, what would it be?
Hey, stop. Wait. So Jeff would say wonderful. Also, Corey, me and
I
you.
I say duplicitous.
Stamper, before you bounce,
like
what's
word.
Your word?
What's duplicitous?
It means you're two-faced.
God damn it, what's your
it's
word?
It's what pseudo-intellectuals use to say the people
oh, dude. Yeah. I hate the word lovers. I hate
oh,
words.
Lovers.
That's a good word.
Ew.
That's actually a pretty good word.
That's the best one.
Because it's really
lovers.
Like layered and
in
weird.
My opinion, moist is just like disgusting. Moist.
Moist and lovers.
I've heard that
moist.
One. Like
yeah,
moist
but what if
panties.
You came over to like Niall's house and he like made chicken and it was really moist and you
I don't
wanted
like
to tell
moist.
Me.
I don't like
what if
word.
I said these two chickens are moist lovers?
I hate it.
Any
dude.
Word any word that's for 12-year-olds, but like people that are 30 say like words like
epic?
Like epic or butthurt or things like
oh,
that.
Oh god, butthurt?
Like,
burn that fucking
like,
word, dude.
Jeff, do you know 30-year-olds
well,
butthurt
isn't even,
lay
it's not
epic,
even
no.
a word.
I'm just saying
it.
Online. I'm just saying
I don't know.
You see people say it, but you know, like...
My grasp is people online that I meet in real life that like quote Chris and Zach that go yeah and stuff.
Oh yeah,
ooh, that may be cringe.
Yeah.
That's my people.
I will say this, and it has nothing to do with my personal situation, but I've always felt that the word nuptials was a really fucking weird ass gross
What's
word.
What's it mean?
It's basically marriage.
Dude, I've never heard that.
Nuptials.
That's some like crazy. Like,
but can I say, with what you said, Joe, I've met people, I've talked to people, at least talked to people who say butthurt in real life, and every time I hear someone say butthurt, over voice, I cringe. I actually physically
I hate the term butthurt,
recoil.
And epic.
It's weird talking to people.
It's because I feel both of those words are used as like single word responses
if,
to
if
just
you're listening, please
like
don't use
being
the word
a fucking asshole. It's like the perfect way to like, if you were to voice your opinion about something, like, hey, this is how I feel, I just want to be honest, blah, 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 and they just write butthurt. It's just like one of those ways of just being like, I'm going to find the perfect way to just be the most condescending little shit fuck to drop that little seed right in there.
It's
all kids, man.
No, I get it.
Let me turn it around. What words do you really like? One of my favorite words is coin.
Coin?
Coin.
Get the fuck out of here, Stamper.
Coin is a cool word.
Yeah.
Coin.
It's
coin.
Got like, it's got punch
it's
to it.
It's got boing to it.
I like pussy.
It does.
I like the term pussy. Like when you hear it, it's
pussy.
Just
pussy.
Coin. Pussy.
Pussy.
Stamper, pussy.
Pussy.
Chris, pussy.
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 Pussy. Pussy. I think a pussy. I think a fucking pussy.
I call people cunts a lot because it's like the last bad word.
Cunts
is a
good word.
It's like the last bad word that exists.
If you call it cunt.
You know what? After we're done with cunt, I don't know. We're out of bad words.
It's one syllable. You could direct it at somebody.
I like
fucking
cunt. It's so punctual.
It is.
Cunt.
It's like fuck.
You're fucking
cunt. Hold on. No, seriously. Jeff has said cunt to me like three times. Not to me.
Wait.
But in reference to other things. And I knew that he meant it. Every
realistically, I would say I like butt more than like.
But I think it's because you could say
butt.
You
say you
butt.
Butt.
Yeah.
No, butt. The term butt.
Like
butt.
Ring.
Like
Sonic
butt.
Ring.
No, like butt.
Like ring is a solid word. What's words that you like? This podcast is negative.
Butts. What
we talked about 9/11 shit that we hate and
no,
everything
I like
in between.
That.
Reckoning.
My cunt. Mom said. My like mom cunt. Gave out to me recently for saying cunt on Facebook. She stalked my Facebook page and I called my ex-girlfriend a cunt. And she gave out like really.
Now, are we just smoking in the office now?
You're a grown man.
Is that what's happening? We're just literally lighting up right here in the fucking office.
What Jeff said, I like the word cunt because it has gravitas behind it. It's like cunt.
I'm worried.
You
what
cunt?
Words are we gonna use?
No, you know what's funny
worn out.
Is what was his name? Louis C.K.
I need
he's
angry
like
words.
He's like the fucking most popular, one of the most popular comics in America,
right.
Especially from liberal audiences.
Yeah.
Right. And he calls his own like 5-year-old daughter back then a cunt.
Yeah.
And he fucking throws that word around a lot.
Yeah.
Cunt.
I don't know what my point was.
He's used it in every single way. He's talked about calling her cunt. He's said, I've cleaned out her cunt.
He's fucked her cunt.
Isaac, I've cleaned shit out
I've
of her cunt.
Licked her cunt. Yeah.
Favorite word is dink.
Dink
is a good word.
Because it's like dick, but not a dick.
But see, if you say dink, I have to say donk or doink.
Doink.
Chris, what word do you like better, lucky or charms?
Oh, get it.
Is
what,
that
what word do you like
I'm
better?
Irish
no, 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 no. What do you like better, Jameson or potato?
Lol.
Lol.
You're making me XD.
Ruffle. Put that on the XD.
Wait, my least favorite word is merge.
Marge.
Yeah.
Marge.
Like the name.
Hey, wait.
Yeah.
Let's have a little mini segment here, Corey.
Yo.
What's this week's new like hot internet words?
Hot internet words?
Yeah.
The word I've heard like a lot recently. I don't know if it's like the hot internet word, but the term I've heard is salt. Like salty.
Oh yeah.
Oh
yeah.
That's old.
No, but it's like
it's
way more popular
back,
now.
That's been a word that's been in the, like the fighting game.
Salty.
Scene for a
salty.
Long time.
Okay. Realistically.
Before
no,
that.
I recently saw that because
no,
I'm rice
salty,
pirate. People have been throwing the salt word.
No, realistically,
yeah,
salty, salty has replaced butthurt.
Yeah.
100%.
Salty.
People say, "Oh, you're salty," because they don't want to say butthurt.
It means you're kind of
you're bitter.
You're bitter, annoyed, upset.
Yeah. So someone
usually they. Say like when you lose and you look upset, you're salty.
Yeah, really? I feel like I've seen the term salty like way more than.
Apparently,
I've seen
that word originated in the 80s, but it only kind of
came back.
I'm telling
back.
You, dude, idiot and moron. Are
I feel like a lot of
80s
ones come back. They're like
saying
blade.
Idiot.
I love moron.
I love idiot.
Good
I fucking love
fucking
both
idiot.
Of those are actually
yeah,
really
calling,
good.
You fucking
calling
moron.
Someone a fucking
moron
idiot is
has
the worst
a nice
insult.
Like
what's
flow.
What's your favorite insult?
Moron.
Idiot. My favorite insult is fucking idiot.
I think retard's pretty strong.
Retard is.
Corey, you are a fucking retard.
Yeah.
if you sit
about,
in your leg.
What about Zach? You're a fucking idiot.
What about your big ol' Egypt?
I like calling nerdy kids. I like calling them Poindexter.
Melvin.
I hope that comes back.
I think Melvin's
you'll never get credit for it.
You fucking
ever.
It's way. I think it's
Melvin is the best nerd word.
Fucking Melvin. It just always hurts the middle.
Yo, we gotta blaze through this. So the next one, and we don't need everybody here because some people bailed for the second. But
fucking Fillmore.
Ryan Pagonis asks, "What are the chances of SleepyCast crew attending conventions outside of the U.S.?"
I would love to if I got paid for it.
We'd love to if we could.
With
chances, if they want to fucking pay,
yeah,
there you go.
If
they pay for it, 100%. If they don't, 0%. Next question. This is from Ellie. She's actually here in Philly. She came to too many games. Very quaint lady. Ideally, what is the future of Sleepy Cabin as you see it, podcast-wise and beyond?
You know,
lots of stuff.
You know volcanoes?
It's over, Johnny.
Yeah.
Do you know how volcanoes, how they erupt?
It's over!
Yeah.
Volcanoes erupt and the lava goes down.
Yeah. Alright.
And then it dries up and then everyone forgets about it.
And then new, more fertile things grow around it.
On top of it.
That's right. Alright, that's your answer. Freakajeebus asks, can you elaborate on your experiences in college? Wow, that really limits it just to me, because all these fucking uneducated assholes never even went to school.
Jeff went to college.
What were your majors? Did any of you actually get your degrees? And if not, what caused you to drop out?
No, I completely failed. I got 0% at college.
Alright, Corey got a 0%.
And Jeff actually went to school.
What's your college experience?
Dropped out.
You dropped out before
Chris.
You even went.
Yeah, Chris, dropped out?
I went for 2 years almost, and then I dropped out.
2 years dropped out. What made you drop out?
The lack of coolness.
Lack of coolness. What about you, Zach? Why didn't you attend at all?
It was really
I don't think
anyone
got you, but I'll
talk about my experience too.
Yeah.
Yeah, hold on.
Zach was answering, but yes, you can too.
My story, I don't think I've ever told before. My story is basically I enrolled in college completely, but I made a promise to myself. I said, if I make a certain amount of money per month on YouTube and through other places, if I make a certain amount.
So this is just recently.
A couple years ago.
What were you going to college for?
I was going to go for graphic design.
Okay.
Which, by the way, horrible. But anyways.
Yeah, I did that.
I had all my courses enrolled. I had a room. I had everything.
Fuck fonts. Thank you.
I enrolled. I had all my stuff in. I bought all the books. I literally, days before, I met that cap.
Yep.
The day, so I said, fuck this. I went, and it was the best choice I ever made in my life. Because I would have not been able to, I wouldn't have made choices that would have allowed me to do what I do now.
Who are you, who you are now? Jeff, what about you? Did you go to college? And if so, did you graduate?
Sorry, let me interrupt. What was the question?
College. You'll figure it out when we ask it. Jeff, did you go to college? What did you go for? And did you graduate? And if you didn't graduate, why didn't you graduate?
College is a completely different beast. You're talking about school.
He's answering.
College.
Here's a question for here. Let me rework this question for everybody. Everybody here is art and animation and other things. What do you think would be the... Who had, the largest leap from what they originally wanted to do to what they're doing now?
Oh, God. I think I win that. I did biomedical science, and I was learning how to be a doctor.
Biomedical science to homeless man.
To man who...
what a leap!
Dude, what a leap. No,
nice leap, dude.
The leap here was...
Epic leap, dude.
It's like stubbing your foot.
While I was studying...
Sorry. Continue now.
While I was studying how to be a doctor, I realized, I always loved the animation, and I always kind of did it. When I was 15, I started doing animation, and then I, kind of stopped for a few years, and I was like, you know, being a doctor was going to give you more money. But then when
now,
I started
was that
doing...
you or your parents?
My parents were part of it, too. I try to make them...
Hiya!
Yeah.
There you go.
No, you're dead right.
I feel like as a doctor, your bedside manner would be awesome. You would give me the confidence that I would live till tomorrow. But knowing you, I'd be a little bit afraid that you were doing surgery.
Yeah, you wouldn't want me to do open heart surgery on you, Mick. However, though, what happened was I was in med school. I was doing open heart surgery on dead people. And then I decided, I was doing animation at the time, too. That's when I became afraid. What happened was I was in a lab. I was on a lab where we could.
He had a fucking Wacom pen on the heart and he was trying to draw it back to life.
That's not, just This is the profession of truth.
No. You know what actually happened was I was in a medicine laboratory and I was excited about the Skyrim game and I was looking up Skyrim stuff.
Oh my god, how
and
old?
I saw Harry's
how
cartoon.
Old is fucking Skyrim.
I saw Harry's cartoon about Skyrim, you know, the one where it was like
what is it?
Yeah. So I watched Harry's cartoons about Skyrim and then that sparked my passion for animation and then through that I found Chris. Then I found Zach. I became a huge fan of all those guys. Then I found Jeff. Then I found Stamper. Then I found Mick. And
you're a liar. You never found me.
Last but not least,
I absolutely found you. I found you in about 2012, Mick. I found you like really early on.
Last but not least, cream of the crop.
No, I found all you guys. Corey. No. Corey was one of the first. I made a fan animation for you, Corey.
Did you really?
I did.
What was it?
Then through that, I met my girlfriend who knew Zach, who I talked to Zach, then who knew Chris, obviously, and then I talked to Chris, and then I moved in with Chris, and then I became Empire State Family.
As far as college, I went for acting, and then this is where I ended up. Hector.
We're just talking about school.
Yeah.
Hector. I didn't finish high school. What? I never went to college.
Oh, that's right. You were racing cars like a fucking, like your little fucking, what do they call it? Tokyo Drift asshole.
Hector.
Hector I asks.
And he sends us good stuff.
What is a condiment or a spice that you guys and gals always put an excess amount because of how goddamn good it is?
I like mustard. Thank you.
Mustard is great. Okay, really
hot
quick.
Hot sauce.
Yeah, no, hot sauce is absolutely the top.
I hate hot sauce. I love
Chipotle!
Mustard.
Chipotle, absolutely. Hot sauce. When I went to England, I loved mustard.
What's that shit, buffalo?
I ordered a meat pie.
It's like buffalo
and
sauce?
I told him I liked mustard. I didn't know this before, but if you go to England and you get a meat pie at like an old school fucking restaurant, you ask for mustards, they give you a cart. Yeah, they give you a cart, and there's like 40 different fucking mustards they put on that fucking cart.
What is one condiment everybody here refuses to use? I don't use relish.
Horseradish.
Oh, fuck you.
Horseradish. See, love horseradish.
I like horseradish.
Let me tell you something, Jeff. Zach loves relish on his hot dogs.
Zach introduced me to relish.
That's a really mustard. Okay. Relish. You can't have a dog.
Care.
You can't have a dog.
Dude, relish is actually pretty good.
I was against Worcestershire sauce for a really long time.
Is it because it gave you cancer?
No, it was like this weird, like, sugary, whatever.
We're talking over each other.
Yeah.
It opens up your knees and cavities.
But Worcestershire sauce, it ended up, it's not something I throw on top of things, but it's something I cook with now.
Fuck hot sauce.
No. It's something I cook with that then adds like a nice sugary texture to it.
Worcestershire sauce is disgusting.
No, I would never add it on top of something after
I cooked. Dude, every time you come over to our place to eat, more than likely there's Worcestershire sauce in it.
And you like it.
Damn, it's alcohol in his system.
It's an ingredient.
No, that's true. Whenever he comes over to our house, he's got alcohol in the system eventually.
My off days with buffalo sauce.
I'm half drunk when I'm eating.
What?
Sometimes I'm just like, ugh. And then it is. I'm like, yeah.
Hey.
Oh, no, buffalo sauce is amazing.
Corn.
You guys all eat chicken fingers all day. What are you talking about?
Listen, I'm on your side. For me, when I was growing up, my dad always got me Old Bay. And I was really attached to Old Bay.
Disgusting thing.
Dude, my dad always got me Old Bay.
You don't like Old Bay?
I just thought that...
God, you're a picky eater. How do you live?
Get out of here.
I actually, when I got like hot dogs and stuff, my parents used to always make brats. So I got really used to mustard. Because mustard and brats
is
the
absolutely.
Best.
Nope, that's sauerkraut.
Yeah, I like
sauerkraut. Yeah.
No, I do like relish. Like, I don't like sauerkraut.
Well, no, I was going to say brats and sauerkraut.
Sauerkraut, I'm not a fan of, but relish is good.
Sauerkraut's good. I started getting this savory
relish
taste.
Relish is just sweet pickles.
I know. No, relish is great.
And
I
goes good on
this,
everything.
I started getting this savory palate. Really. Zach actually kind of introduced me to it. I was more of like a kid. I was like eating sweet chips.
Well, no, it's not that you're a kid. It's because you're from another country where your tastes.
Sweet palate is actually more like thing in Ireland.
And you know what the weird thing is? It's like, for example, today me and Mick went to the store, and it was a grocery store that I've been to once, but he hasn't been to. So I was like, come check out this grocery store because they have a lot of good ingredients for cooking and shit. Mm-hmm. And in the back, they had bags of crickets, And mealworm.
I saw that on Twitter.
Yeah, and then we picked them up and we ate them and it was great. And they were like really nice.
The honey crickets?
The crickets were way better than the mealworms.
The crickets are awesome.
But here's the thing. Like, I would take those any day over beets. Like, I hate beets.
Fuck you. I like beets too.
No, beets.
Go back to your house and fuck beets.
Beets are fucking disgusting. Not only do they stain absolutely everything, but they have no fucking taste.
Look, I'm not
No taste? You're eating the wrong beets. You have a beet salad with some arugula.
Soggy,
and some
like,
gorgonzola? God damn it, you guys don't know fucking...
Well, yeah, the salad and the gorgonzola is what makes it good, Mick.
You know what beets reminds me of? Fucking cooked carrots.
Gorgonzolas.
Not existing.
No,
cooked carrots are fucking nasty.
No, they're good to stew.
No, absolutely not.
Canned
beets, takes most
canned beets are a fucking travesty.
Yeah, who said canned beets, though?
No, beets are fucking nasty. By the way, you fucking dish it.
I hate tomatoes.
Sorry.
I will eat a tomato
I'm
rock.
Sorry. I
what
hate
is it? Maybe it's because I'm Chinese,
tomatoes.
But everything.
Tomatoes
I can find
are the,
joy
shit.
In everything.
Chris
hate, no,
you don't
Tom
like tomatoes?
Like tomatoes?
No.
Can I talk? Can I talk about something about Mick for like
Listen,
one second?
Listen, I like tomatoes. I like grilled tomatoes.
Go now, bro. Can I talk about something about Mick for
Why?
One second?
This is not the question.
So we go out and we buy wings. No matter where we go, we always get wings. I eat my wings to the best of my ability. I think it is done. Mick finishes it like a hyena.
Yes.
Mick like. Finishes it like he makes it like just bone that is shiny. You can see her.
Corey does that too. Everyone in the comments is gonna say you should finish your wings.
I finish my wings in my opinion.
Mick and Corey
Mick makes it like just
the
bone.
Mick and Corey.
You know what?
Both.
I agree. You know what? You want to know something though? People always ignore the fact that there's meat on everything, and you can still taste the meat on the.
No, no, I agree too. It's like where I do not see meat, Mick sees meat.
Of course.
Where I say, where I'm like it's done.
I'm like fucking
Mick's like no, this is the beginning.
If you ever really eat with me, even after we finish our meal, if there's a nice thick bone, I will crack
Mick
right through
crack
that bone,
Mick,
and
Mick's
I will
like,
suck on the cartilage. I absolutely will.
He eats the cartilage.
No,
eats,
I will. I will.
What annoys you more, the fact that people clean their bones or the fact that somebody sucks?
It doesn't annoy me. It fascinates me. I like it. I swear to God, I wish I was that.
It's gross.
Chris, you don't like tomatoes, right?
No.
Which is weird
Dude,
to me because
what's really bizarre to me is like growing up, my dad told me like he would basically ground me if I didn't eat vegetables. So
like
at a young age, I learned to like vegetables, and it was to a point where my dad would actually buy me like tomatoes, and that
I
was like
go,
fruit roll-ups for me.
I would go so far as to say I love tomatoes. I used to actually drink tomato juice.
He would get
people would be like, oh, it's fucking ketchup. You know, tomato juice is fucking delicious. I'll still drink.
Dude, you know what,
Zach?
My dad. I like carrot juice. I like carrot juice. A lot of people don't like carrot juice. I like carrot juice.
I drink tomato juice all the time.
Zach,
it's fucking good.
Zach loves the most possibly repugnant thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
Are you talking about blue cheese olives?
Blue cheese olives.
I'll do it.
I
know what,
Jeff?
Me and you
that is,
are.
That's like smegma.
Hold on.
Really?
Stepper. Yes.
Zach, before you start this, that's like smegma testicles. Now continue.
And they're delicious.
I mean, I wouldn't eat them for a meal.
Do any of you hate olives?
Jeff.
Yes.
No, I love olives.
Yes. Hate olives. I love.
Jeff. I don't want to be the harbinger of bad news, but I actually
harbinger. Olives are like trick
grapes. I actually
you
like
think
blue
you're eating grape, and it's like shits in your mouth.
Because I like blue cheese. Because I like blue cheese.
You know what I think? I think if you grow up a picky eater, then you had a shitty mom. I will say that right now.
Damn.
Because she just gave you everything that you wanted. Little Jeffy wants macaroni and cheese. Little Chris doesn't enjoy
you
tomatoes.
You drove a car off a highway and almost killed yourself.
Yeah, well, people do stupid shit.
How good of a mom did you have?
What? A bad one because I'm an alcoholic now.
Alcoholic.
Look, my mom smoked, and well, she wasn't an alcoholic. I brought that on myself, but she gave me the smoking thing.
Let me tell you something. At a young age, my dad taught me to enjoy Brussels sprouts and broccoli.
How dare you?
I was raised on.
He did a good job.
Except for beets and cooked carrots.
Your water people family did half okay.
Yeah, I'll kill all of you for my.
Enough with the water people.
If my mother said these all you have to die, I would do it.
Yeah, you know,
how much I love my mother.
If you were drinking fucking chloroform every single
like
fucking day,
and
you know, like this green liquid pouring into fucking jugs at our fucking backwater town,
Enough of me drinking the chloroform.
We broke the Travis S. asks, is there anything you guys can tell us about the projects you are currently working on? All right.
no.
Quick, go!
Corey and I are working on an enormous, enormous game that'll one day be done, but not soon.
But it looks amazing. Next.
I saw
No, it does look amazing.
I saw the prototype, it looked great.
And well, you know what? I need to step in on that, too.
I want you to!
Listen, you gotta voice the girl character.
Like, yeah.
You gotta
can I voice a girl
it
character?
Looks no, you definitely fucking should. Amazing. It's not even kind of amazing. It literally looks... You know, even Tom... Yo, when I spoke with Tom, he even said, I haven't seen a game like this. That makes me happy, because I agree.
Dude,
sometimes
that's
I don't...
good, because I'm tired of working 7 days a week. I want to be good.
It is amazing. All right, next.
Tom took his old game.
Yes, that's right. He
Tom
said about his
own
game
and said, I've never
correct.
Seen a game look this
that's
good.
Right. That's right. He did. He did say that. All right, Zach, Chris, what are you working on?
Hellbenders.
That's awesome.
Take Jeff's answer to replace Gabe with Hellbenders. There you go.
Which I saw clips of what they've been working on. I laughed. I legitimately laughed.
They're doing a lot of good stuff. Like the animation's great, and the fucking backgrounds look amazing.
Well, thank you.
Thanks, man.
The animation. The animation's funny.
The
jokes. The
timing's great.
Let me clarify this. We're all winners.
Yeah, we're all winners.
The jokes seem like.
Thanks, Mark.
Can I say
Jeff.
Can I actually say something though? The jokes seem like years beyond the internet shorts. The jokes seem actually like they're from. Like these guys have been working for years and years. Even though it was only like a year since the last internet short, 2 years. It seems like it is actually just stages and stages beyond the last thing that came out from Hellbenders. And I'm not just saying that. That's actually the truth.
Wow, it better be that good.
No, it is that good.
Now,
well, whatever.
You're on the chopping block now.
You think I give a fuck?
I don't give a fuck.
Say whatever.
Because you got like a whole season to do.
I don't care what you say. Right?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, if he gets picked
except
up.
Except,
listen,
clear.
Whatever. Whatever.
I grabbed the dick and I kissed it.
Yeah, I grabbed. Look, I grabbed the asshole.
You're my friend.
I grabbed the asshole.
Samper, what are you working on?
It's funny. It's
can
good.
I, can
what's
I ask,
current project
well, hey,
you're working
hold on,
on?
Hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. Can I ask? Show of hands. Who here is drunk? Because you guys are also pretty drunk.
I'm drunk. Oh, dude.
Show of hands.
Yeah,
right now.
We're
all
half
drunk.
Hand, half hand, half
started. I don't think Samper's drunk. I don't think Samper's that drunk.
I'm fine.
He's fine.
Nicholas asks,
dude, let's go over the record book.
Do you feel that the financial struggle Sleepy Cabin goes through strengthens you as a group?
No.
If so, do you also feel that financial success might weaken you as a whole?
You're like Daredevil, Stan.
All right, okay. Number one, we don't actually go through that much
we've
financial
been all through
struggle.
A lot.
Yeah, as far as the financial success.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, as far as I know.
Yeah, no, as far as you know, dude. As far as our huge financial
you haven't been almost kicked out of the warehouse fucking 12 months in a row because people can't pay their rent on time.
All right.
Niall!
Give me Stanford. I don't know.
In our mailing bill.
Financial trouble.
Our mailing bill.
Dude, makes us fucking spend $400 yesterday and today mailing packages and nobody gives a shit about.
And we actually still have
finances.
We actually still have. We still have a bunch of stuff to send out.
I don't know about the finances at all.
Actually, you're not part of.
That's funny because it's actually.
Bang.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I'm sorry. You know, I try to do my part.
Well, listen, Corey. What's interesting about that statement is that all of the Sleepy Cabin finances are absolutely available. If you go to the Sleepy Cloud, you will see
what
all
is that?
It's in the Google Docs that we have. It's if you go to the folder of our Google
me?
Docs.
I don't use Google.
All right, next question.
Super cool, cool, like you. That needs to be on a fucking shirt. That was beautiful, Chloe.
I paid you like
you,
3 days ago.
Love
did you get your money or not?
Fuck.
I don't check Facebook.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I don't use Google.
I can't keep talking about this without.
You guys, you know who doesn't get money?
He does such a good job. He's here all day. And he's just.
All right, guys. Next question before I kill myself. Clock Watcher. Well, no, it's only because we spend about fucking 40 hours a month trying to make this thing work in terms of like the financials. If you've never looked at it, it's there. I made it public so you could see it. I just want to move on.
Hold on,
Corey. We'll talk about it later. I just want to move on.
Email me on my email. You email me.
You
message me on Skype.
I'll do that for the first time ever, Corey.
Thank you.
Yeah. Next fucking question.
This is
question.
Too realistic.
Clock Watcher asks the next amazing question. It is...
The question he hasn't asked yet, by the way.
Are there any particular objects or tools in your dreams that do not function properly? I'm sorry, I'm Clock Watcher, goodbye.
Next question,
Mick.
All right. Would you guys want to expand on the studio, bringing on or in other artists...
Whatever.
or helping other projects out?
No.
Yeah, I think eventually yes, but that we're trying to fend for ourselves at this point still. I mean, so once that's out thriving. Of,
are you talking about like bring on like people to help us make content or?
Yes.
I don't know. Well, Corbin just is basically asking, would you guys want to expand on the studio, bringing on other artists? So yeah, I'm assuming let's like
say, maybe
I
not
think,
yet.
I'll tell you this. I think a lot of people have assumed, a lot of people have asked if we're gonna have a similar to you know Newgrounds kind of thing where it's user submitted. I don't think we'll ever have that, but eventually.
I don't think that's what it is.
Sky,
I think it's more like hey, collaborating.
No, you should people touch on them. That because there are people that think that it should be the Newgrounds.
People too. People ask that a lot. Pie in the sky. Our ideal thing is selectively picking and paying and bringing on and promoting people
yes.
who we enjoy. So very exactly. selective, a club, a little gay club.
So pretty much producing
absolutely.
Good content.
Producing, like producing instance, is the
right,
best
and it's
word.
Not elitist. It's just quality
selective,
control and yeah. fucking hiring.
I've
people.
Never liked the term producing.
Well,
I've
no,
never,
because
it's
producers
the only
are
one
dicks.
That's applicable here, though. It's applicable.
But it is literally it, what we want to do.
It may not be a good one, but it's applicable. All
right.
What
so next
say?
Up, we got
what
we got. Electric Doom. And
hey guys, we got Electric Doom hitting us up with a question here. Mick, take us away.
What's your guilty pleasure?
Why did you do that?
What's your guilty pleasure is the question.
Guilty pleasure?
Guilty pleasures.
Hey, jerk it off, dude.
Jeff, what's your guilty pleasure?
You,
do you have a pleasure
know.
That you feel weird about liking?
Why should you know what? Guilty
know.
Pleasure always translates to something you're embarrassed about.
Right.
But why be embarrassed about something that you
that's
like?
That's correct. Yes.
Like a guilty pleasure movie. You know what? You fucking love Demolition Man. Why can't you like Demolition Man?
Okay, first of all, that's an amazing movie. Nobody thinks it's a guilty pleasure.
80s music. I don't know.
Yeah, there you go. That's me.
80s music. That's the best.
Everyone likes.
You know what? You're
music.
Right. That's
here's,
a terrible
here's
question.
Here's a real guilty pleasure. NPR. I'm a total old man. There you go. That's
right.
A real guilty pleasure because you're all gonna crucify me.
Yeah,
go ahead, Stepper.
I'll crucify you.
All right,
you know what?
No one's crucifying
you.
You
want to know what my guilty pleasure is?
No. Go ahead.
What are you, 90?
You want to know what my guilty pleasure is?
Yes.
What are you, 90
hold
years
on.
Old?
Hold on! I'm raising my fucking hand for school, okay? My guilty pleasure is watching, like, speedruns and people, like, talking about nonsense and just basically watching people run the same fucking game I grew up with, like,
now,
the same
Cord,
10 games.
Why do you do that?
I don't. I
what
just,
what possesses you to do that? Why do you?
I have this like.
Why at 11 p.m. at night you just feel the urge to cut that on?
Yeah.
And fall asleep to that.
Because I'm still a big fan of that kind of stuff. I'm
it
still a big
you,
fan. Yeah. I'm still
it's
comforted
a relic
by
from your childhood.
You know what, Corey?
Yeah.
Corey, I'm with you. Because sometimes when I'm working out on my rowing machine, I want to watch a speed through of Dark Souls.
Yes!
Or.
Yes!
Or
you watch a game! You watch a game! You play!
And
clean.
I only want to watch it because I, while I'm working out, I want
Mick,
to see
you want
to
tell the fans you're working out.
Here's
well,
the thing.
No, that's yes, that's
that
too.
That's exactly what it is.
Doing enough of it.
Keep going.
Northern just listening
continue.
To the podcast.
Continue!
We're pumping that iron, you
today,
know?
Today!
When I'm on the. Oh, no, seriously, when I'm on the rowing machine, I do like to watch other people
the rowing
play.
Machine.
Exactly.
The game, and I do like to watch
no,
them
it's
do
completely
it in
true.
A way that I wouldn't normally do it.
Today I watched a 3-hour, 100% run of a Mario Sunshine. Today.
And you've already done that.
Yeah, I played Mario Sunshine.
But you
want
to see somebody else
is.
Do it.
I want to see, like, some insane individual map out exactly how he would beat the game at the fastest time.
On another note, Stamper and Jeff, have you guys ever just watched guys play, like, a Street Fighter game and just
oh,
to
absolutely.
Watch how they play?
Yeah.
Sure.
I'm watching Evo right now.
And there's nothing weird about that.
No! There's nothing.
I consider it a strategy. I'm watching.
Well,
a strategy.
There's a
I'm
difference
really
between
watching
a game for 5 minutes versus watching something for 4 hours.
Well, yeah. A 4-hour watch is a game
it's like
walkthrough.
A chess match.
All right, I know where this is going.
I love you
okay,
first.
So Zach.
No. I know it sounds hypocritical, but seriously, Street Fighter matches are over within a minute. But why would you watch Minecraft for 6 straight
whoa,
hours?
I never said I watch Minecraft. I would watch Bloodborne or Dark Souls right, because
Zach
I want to
watch.
Why would you watch Bloodborne?
Because I
want
to see the strategy level for level, moment to moment. Because it's not just a 2-3 minute match, it is a whole fucking game.
Do you
skip ahead? Do you cut off?
Yeah. There are parts where I'm like, oh, I know what happens.
I would watch a 6-hour Let's Play of someone playing Minecraft if it was like an interesting concept.
Zach, what's your guilty pleasure?
Like, maybe they think it's fascinating that that you sit and animate all day.
That's true. Would you really want to watch me do the same fucking animation for 14 hours?
Nobody people wants to did it when you did the Street Fighter thing for Aaron. Next. That's
true.
Anyway,
Michael Westermeyer says...
No, wait, Zach didn't answer.
Oh, sorry.
I don't answer. I said NPR is a guilty pleasure.
And yeah, I
make fun of me.
I just admitted that I sometimes would jack off to the trap.
You're going to want this out of the podcast. I know you.
What? I said I did.
Okay, he jacks off to trap. All right.
I did.
He's going to want that cut out.
All right. Michael Westermeyer asks...
Let's cut it.
Nobody cares! It's over.
I've jacked off to a trap multiple times.
What are you, high? Nobody cares.
Michael Westermeyer asks, what's something you love but everyone else seems to hate?
Jersey Shore.
Jeff, you first. Let's go.
I don't know. Man, I wish I had more than like 1 second to think about this.
Fast and the Furious.
Do you want to get back to you?
Fast and Furious 3.
Fast and Furious 7.
You Freddy, love that, but other people hate it.
Oh, Freddy got fingered.
Fuck you, Chloe. Fuck you.
Freddy got fingered.
All right, okay.
The Walking Dead always seemed...
really?
Well, hold on. It's pretty hated,
I don't
too.
Like it, dude.
You hate
so
it?
It's not awful. Yeah, I hate it. It's not that unpopular, by the way.
That's your first question.
It's one of those... It's one of those.
Something you like, but everybody else hates.
Oh, is it? It's the opposite?
Yeah, something you love.
Oh, okay,
But wow, we hate but dick.
Okay, sure. Sorry, I apologize.
Yeah, you just like immediately hated on something.
Videos of a dude pissing on the walls in the McDonald's bathroom.
I agree, though.
That I like.
Can I not say that I don't like The Walking Dead?
Axis Powers.
Wow, Axis Powers. There you go. Japan, come on. Knock some more ships down.
What do you love that other people hate, Zach? Come on.
The movie with Arnold Schwarzenegger where he's defeating the Antichrist. What's that called?
Eighth day. Seventh day. Yeah. Sixth day.
Little Nicky.
That would be such a guilty pleasure, but I love it. I don't know why. It's such a shitty movie, but I love
day
it.
Was where he calls
so fucking stupid.
Oh, yeah, shit.
What's that's the one? It, sixth day. I think it's the sixth day.
Something no. That's the one where he clones himself. What's the other one?
Oh, the End of Days?
It's called
End of Days. Yeah.
It's such
right.
a shitty
right.
fucking movie, but every End time it's on, I have
that's
to watch...
That's where he fights the devil.
I have to watch all of it. Yeah. I have to
for
watch
me,
all of
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I don't watch it too.
Every time
it,
it's
yeah,
on, yeah. For me, I have to watch all of it.
For me, it will always be Freddy Got Fingered. It will always be that movie.
I often love to watch the entire trilogy or quadrilogy of Resident Evil Upright Order of Pizza. The end.
I like the first Resident Evil movie. Even though it's so bad.
I can get to it, but...
No, I will watch those with absolute pleasure. I will order a pizza and watch all of the Resident Evil movies.
Resident Evil movies!
I will do it.
You disgust me.
Listen,
horrible.
I didn't say I like them.
But I kind of liked them too.
The first movie's got really good music and atmosphere.
That actually mixes with the guilty pleasure thing too. I will order a pizza, I will buy a bottle of vodka, and I will consume both of them while I watch every single fucking movie.
Look,
Chris, what do you say? Is that your guilty pleasure?
Wait, I didn't even get to
this. This is a guilty pleasure?
Oh my god, what the fuck?
Okay, my guilt,
please show me this isn't real.
My only guilty pleasure.
It's your girlfriend. Fuck off.
Ended years ago.
What was it?
Jersey Shore.
Yeah, Jersey Shore, dude.
Wait, you like Jersey Shore?
That's mine as well.
I used to love that.
Me and Chris love Jersey Shore, dude. Cabs here.
Cabs here.
Cabs here.
We're faggots.
I will never defend you on that.
I know, it's fine. Look, it's obviously garbage.
Yeah, it's so bad, but it's.
You know what? I can understand now why you guys, because it's like the whole like concept of it is just like so fucking out of the world.
No, it is
like tragic alien interaction.
It was so different than our lives that we thought it was funny because like it was just so stupid. It was good to
like
laugh at
like a stark contrast between life in Ireland versus life in America.
That's it. Yeah.
Is that what you thought life in America would be?
At the time we did.
A beach on Jersey.
We thought that was the time in New Jersey.
And everyone was like, yo, we need to go get some roast beef sandwiches.
I'd never seen Guidos before. It was new.
Yeah, the Guidos were like brand new back then.
And like two of the guys grow on you.
Just like loosely throw out Guido.
And a couple of the guys were like, they did grow on you. You like them.
And the other ones are so fucking
stupid.
Vinny
and Polly,
yeah.
Vinny and Polly, yeah.
Yeah, they guided on you.
They did.
Shane Daniels asks, do you have any other big ideas like Hellbenders you want to do after Hellbenders?
Yes.
Like a mixed, really sweet sounding medieval fan. Okay, fuck you, Shane. Yeah, no, I had an idea. Do you guys have any ideas you want to do after helping?
I want to check off the traps, man.
Yes, but they're secrets.
I want to surprise people.
All right. Stamper and I still plan on doing a cooking show. I'm just saying
no one knows if I'm joking.
This is going to happen.
It's real. This is real.
I wanted to make...
That would be the best idea ever.
That's
where I want to be.
Mick, you need to go to fucking cooking school before we make a show, man.
You know what? I'm going to teach you how to do some... Fuck you. All right, what's up?
I wanted to turn my failure cartoon thing wonky into something actually worth talking about.
It's not a failure, man.
I wanted to write it into something.
No, he's kind of right. It was a failure.
No, why do you hate it so much?
I wanted to write it into something.
I love Corey and everything he's done, but wonky is hands down the worst.
Give reasons. Give a list.
He made one cartoon.
Bad voice acting. Bad audio. Exactly. Bad everything.
That's
funny.
Why it's funny.
That's why it's
Jeff,
funny.
Someone back me
that
up.
Was
bad
the
audio
point of the
is part of the charm. Versus your capabilities, wonky.
Wonky's
really?
Fucking funny, dude.
Listen, I wanted to write Wonky as like this naive fool who was just learning the human life from a perverted psychopath who knows nothing about life.
Why don't you go pitch that to Pixar?
They would fucking love it, dude.
Corey, you did pitch Wonky.
No.
At fucking Hollywood. We were in the room with you.
You pitched Wonky?
Yeah.
To the fucking trip take.
You pitched Wonky?
Surprise, I fucking remember it, Corey.
I don't remember.
I thought you were fucking psycho.
I don't remember.
Corey, why did you say Wonky?
I don't remember.
You did.
I must have been fucking huffing the pants.
I forgot about that, dude. God, I forgot about that.
Oh, Corey.
I don't remember that.
Corey.
All right, Wingman, Wingman.
What?
Wingman.
He's really sitting there with a fucking blood special. Like, you're a fucking psycho. He was like,
you're a liar.
You
absolutely did.
What did I say?
You were just telling people, okay, I will remember the exact plot. You said that Wonky was its own, like, dream world for kids or something, and blah, 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 right?
Yeah, okay.
You were playing Twitter.
That sounds like nothing I would say.
It was! Why did I, dude? It was fucking...
You
what?
Said...
Yes, dude!
What?
You scared him away,
Corey. Excuse me? Was I fucking huffing on paint chips
or
what?
You got us blacklisted from Hollywood!
I don't remember that!
Corey!
You're a liar!
It did happen! It did!
Never.
Zach was there! Aaron was there!
Cares.
Susie
who cares?
Was there.
It's not getting cut. Who cares?
It's not getting cut. That's funny.
Alright, Wingman 2699 asks, have you guys ever had any relationship problems? If
no.
so, please
Next
elaborate.
Question.
We've got Steven Vauladicus says, what were some obstacles and hardships that you felt while pursuing something you were passionate about? Has anything come close to grinding things to a halt?
Yeah, that time I hired a studio.
And what helped you? And what helped you or didn't help you overcome it?
Chris
How
hired a studio for me.
Time consuming it is. It's really time consuming.
Time.
It's very tedious. If you want to do animation, if you want to do comedy to some extent, it's gonna be very time consuming.
I got swindled from Hollywood.
Chris, just say the fucking.
Yeah, just do it.
No,
it's been
listen, you can dig it up, but I got fucking screwed by a studio out of $6,000. They told me they'd animate an episode of Leo Satan every week or two.
It looked like a fucking 13-year-old.
I gave them a design sheet, and it was supposed to look like Leo Satan 3 and 4, which was decent.
I saw the episode. It looked so fucking
I
bad.
Swear it's on
I saw a link.
I swear they got an intern to do it.
It was them in a field, and like whatever angle they had on them, I've never
but
seen
who,
that.
It was a slightly curved.
And Sean.
It was so curved. It
was weird. It wasn't like a regular episode, anyways. But they still fucked up the animation.
I still think you should release it. Just
for me, it's editing Sleepy Cast and then Sleepy Cabin going to a halt, everybody, and then not having any income.
But that's all, folks. Next question.
All right, Windmill Punches asking, what are your thoughts on tattoos?
Cool, hot, sexy.
How many is too many?
You answer this, Vic. You answer this, because you have a fucking Sleepy Cabin tattoo.
I am the only person in this group that has
I'm
a tattoo.
One, I'm getting
one. A Sleepy Cabin tattoo.
Yeah, well, you...
Do you regret the tattoo?
Not at all.
I wouldn't regret that.
You know what's funny about that? No. It's funny because it's one of those things that I forget that I have it, and every single time I see it on me, I'm actually really fucking happy.
Are you motivated?
What's that?
Are you motivated? Are you inspired?
It doesn't necessarily motivate me. When I see it, I'm just happy to see it. It gives me a smile.
There's a shocking amount of people with Sleepy Cabin tattoos.
There are. There's actually, so far from Twitter.
A good dozen, I think, right?
Well, there's at least eight people that have tweeted it.
But the only reason is because the design is really good.
It's a good tattoo regardless of what it's
Exactly.
It's
a good thing. The skeleton key is just a fucking sexy ass fucking design.
No matter what, it's a very good design.
And for me, I've already said this 100 times, but, you know, people are like, well, what if something happens to Sleep Cat? It's just a reminder of a transition in my fucking life.
Can I talk to Jeff for a second?
And
Jeff,
I'm really fucking happy that I have it. The end. What's
next
that?
Next question.
What's the point now?
Yeah.
It's just that I know you never would. That's the only
reason. You know what? It's the problem. I don't think I could any get it. I
would never get a tattoo.
I would never. You know what? It's so funny. For the longest time, dude,
freak out and get tired of it.
I would have never, ever, ever. I was one of those people who was like, I'm never getting a tattoo. What the fuck would I ever commit to my body that I would ever actually want to put there? And then when things happened in my life and things happened and I came to Philly, I don't know. I just, this is. If Sleepy Cabin dissolved tomorrow, this would be even better and even cooler because it would be such a fucking reminder of something that
it's a relic.
Yeah, all of a sudden it becomes that much more important. Yeah. There's nothing that will ever make me regret
this. Like,
I love it.
Something,
the end.
Some like little homage to it on my half sleeve, but I wouldn't get the like. The thing.
She could tattoo my wiener on there.
If possible, if you can get a tattoo that's less than 2.8 inches, then I would probably do it.
Sorry, it's like 18,000 inches.
No, it costs less.
You know,
it's too little price to get a tattoo.
I'm sorry,
your
and it's shaped in a
Mick,
corkscrew.
You should
get a full size Mick wiener on your pinky.
Yeah,
finger.
You should get half an ant tattooed on your dick because that's all it could fit.
No, because it's
talking about.
All right, we got Keith.
You freak!
Wait, you mean
we've got Keith Rogers.
You get a half a Mick Wiener on my little nub.
Keith Rogers.
I get half a Mick Wiener right here. Look, guys, look at this.
Yeah, right on your wart, we get it. Stop!
Keith Rogers asks, can I visit Philly and crash with you guys?
No.
Okay. No, who are you?
This is a somewhat serious question.
Tell him the fuck off, seriously.
All right. Hey, but don't
maybe
be
he's a
dick.
Nice guy. Maybe he can stay at my house.
He's a great guy. And you know what? He probably ended up staying with us anyway, so shut up,
Niall. Yeah, tell him to fuck off, though.
Nice
oh
house.
My God, Niall.
Tell him to
Iron Phoenix. Iron Phoenix, you are literally like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. You are two different human beings, Niall. All right, Iron Phoenix. If you all were to animate full-length films together, assuming all expenses are paid or payable, who among the Sleepy Cabin would be delegated as the director of that movie?
Chris O'Neill.
Chris. Yeah,
Chris O'Neill.
I give it to Chris.
Whoa, really?
Yeah.
Why?
Because you're a good director. Full stop, you're a good director.
That's true.
Hey. Yeah, also a good knife rapist, Chris O'Neill.
But wait, you were saying animation.
Did you guys really kill this entire...
Did he say animation?
No, they did. If you were all to animate a full length film,
animate.
So I guess it's.
Oh, animate.
So it's
animate. I would still say Chris to some degree. Oh. He's very good at shots. He's very good at composition.
Thanks.
I think so.
Thanks.
Definitely.
I agree. That's good nice. Color and good lighting.
Nice legs.
Yeah. Look at these.
Exactly.
All you gotta do.
Next question, dude.
All you gotta do is tan your albino legs and not be autistic, and then we'd have a
wow. Damn, dude.
All right, next.
You don't want to talk with your fucking.
God damn it, guys. You know what I'm
you
joking.
You asked for it, dude.
Yes. You know what I'm joking. Mm-hmm.
What's the next question?
The next question.
The Box of Shame asks.
Good name.
If you had to relocate Sleepy Cabin to another state.
Antarctica.
Besides.
Next question.
Antarctica is a state.
It's not a state.
And besides Pennsylvania, where would you like to go?
Texas.
Greenland.
Texas.
Greenland. Yeah, because,
Canada.
Zero income tax, right?
Yep.
Washington.
Oh, yeah. And the temperature is fairly regulated.
I
want to
live in a place like Forrest Gump lived in. Fucking trees.
What, Alabama? Nice.
Like, sorry, Alabama,
yeah, I would totally live in his house in cartoons.
You know it's hot as shit.
Not with a big old AC.
Hawaii is a good place. A little expensive, but it's alright.
There's a volcano that's gonna fall on you, though.
Jeff, do your best Hawaiian impression. Moving on!
Amazing! Amazing!
That's the Middle East.
Dog, the bounty hunter lives in Hawaii.
You know what's funny? Is that they have 18 words that rhyme with.
That was
half of their fucking dictionary,
yeah.
To be honest.
That was Syria, that was Iraq.
Notice, wait, isn't there like 35 fucking meanings to Aloha?
No, yeah. Like, you know, Alaska apparently. For snow.
Yeah, it's like.
Yeah. Alaska has 35.
But what is the word? What is the word? Does anyone know?
Aloha means the friendship those
stop
who have
that.
No feet deep within the sand of.
You've been a bad boy, Zach.
Nobody knows.
Sorry,
nobody knows the answer. If there was a place to relocate, Hawaii sounds nice.
Yeah, did you
Texas isn't bad.
Would,
San Diego.
Honestly, Texas would be the biggest one.
I think Texas too.
aloha means
hello.
Those to greet. It was like hello to those who greet deeper than the sand of heat.
What the fuck?
Thank you, fucking homework, dude.
I like your interpretation. I do. No, genuinely.
It's a fucking cut my hand with for my birthday. What the hell's wrong with
that
you?
That was honestly not far off the Sandland thing we said at the beginning. That was just one of those weird things you did.
Yeah. Yeah, other than that, Pennsylvania,
what
Texas.
What are you looking at me like that for?
It's a Quizlet riddle.
San Diego, Hawaii. They did say another state. Otherwise, I'd say Taiwan. Because Taiwan is fucking amazing.
You live in Taiwan?
I would absolutely. They have the number one.
China's going to invade them, dude.
They're fucking. They will. That would be the only down. That would be the only downside. Is that you'd be like, I'm in Taiwan. And all of a sudden, China's like, you're ours. And then you'd be like, oh.
Can we see a little.
That's like the. I thought the Riddler was the Quizzler. I didn't know.
That's like a shitty fucking like
from like Quizzlers.
That's
mad.
Like an Adult Swim parody
you're
of
mad.
The Riddler.
The Quizzler.
Fun fact about Taiwan.
You need to be quizzed on this.
Taiwan says it's the real China.
Yeah.
Oh my God. China says it's the real China.
Yes.
You know that. True or false? Add to that?
When I was in Taiwan just this summer, I went to a deli and they were like, how is your Chinese so good? And I was like, oh, my mom's from Taiwan. I'm half Chinese. And all three ladies behind the counter, their faces went from like, oh, smiling at the foreigner who spoke Chinese to just like stone cold. And they were like, you're not half Chinese.
You're full.
You're half Taiwanese.
Interesting.
And here I was I was still handing money over the counter. Like I was like,
Do people in Taiwan still view themselves as Chinese? Is the real China?
No, they consider themselves Taiwanese.
Interesting.
Absolutely.
Man. Interesting.
No doubt.
Interesting. Have you ever tried to use this Chinese line thing on like women?
But hey,
I am Chinese.
To what? For what purpose?
I don't know. I'm just curious.
To what benefit?
There was an angle. If there's an angle to it.
Well, the problem is that like Chinese is not like Spanish. There's nothing romantic about it. It always sounds like
French.
It always sounds like you're just shouting and yelling. Like even the words like I love you.
Give some
Mandarin. Listen, ladies, I have a Chinese dick.
Yeah, check out my Chinese ding dong is never a pickup line. But
say it in Chinese.
No, but here. I love you.
Say it in Chinese.
Here's I love you in Chinese. What I need.
Okay. What I need.
Yeah, there's nothing like
what
calm
I
or
need.
Soothing about it.
Wait.
Sounds like you're gonna punch somebody.
Say, I wanna finger fuck you until you scream.
Okay, hold on, okay. 我要放我的手在你的 I don't know some of these words.
Okay, say how your voice changes.
What do you mean my voice changes?
It goes higher.
I'm gonna talk in Chinese.
Okay, I'm trying to figure this out, right? So say, I think you're a very pretty lady.
Wait.
你很美丽.
Okay, so do
I sound like an ignorant?
Speak as suavely as you can.
Yeah.
你是一个很漂亮的女人.
Do I sound like I'm saying it?
You were just doing it. You were actually doing the tones too.
你是一个很漂亮的女人.
Is that literally the words? Or am I saying it weird to you?
No. You said everything up and you said you were very pretty and then you stopped.
Oh, 你是一个很漂亮的女人.
No. 你是一个很漂亮的女人. Now you sound like you're a little drunk, but you're still speaking Chinese.
Sweet dude.
It sounds like you're playing a fucking record of bat in reverse.
Yes, that's what it sounds like.
Yeah.
All right, guys.
Shut up.
That's our beautiful language. All right, we've got four more bitch ass. This is from our amazing patrons. Next, we've got Paul Raymond. Commissions from companies or developers. Have any of you done one? How did you feel about it? And will Sleepy Cabin ever consider doing one?
Commissions?
Commissions from another company.
I
would do it.
About 8 months ago, I did a commission for Jash, the video podcast.
By commissions, do you mean jobs?
Yes.
Yes, big commission.
Would you do jobs?
Big commissioned.
to make money outside of
I did what
this.
Bill Reggie
well,
watched.
Gee. Well, you know what? Some people think we make a whole lot of money being the group that we are. Okay, I'm just saying, some people do think that.
Well, I'm just gagging.
And they're patron supporters of
are
it.
Are they
there
talking about us doing, like, have we done individually before Sleepy Cabin?
No, I think what they're actually where's specifically the saying is, as Sleepy Cabin, would we be willing to do jobs?
I'd be willing to do one if it was, like, something we were,
within
like,
the group, right. Within
like,
the,
if we all cared about it, and right. if it, like, was, you know,
well, it's
worth
the
it.
Reason why I think we haven't done, like, the Audible or the Loot Crate shit. Is because it's just, as a group, it's not something that we've been passionate about
I really
about
hate
doing.
Loot Crate. Right. I really just don't get
no,
the point.
No, and I won't cut that out.
Okay, fine.
Good.
It's good.
Because I know we gotta cut some things out, but I think that as a group, like, while we may not necessarily hate the product, or some of us do,
sorry,
as a group,
I don't
it is
hate
not,
the product. I just
no,
don't care about it.
No, I absolutely yeah. agree. No, I absolutely agree. It's just not something as a group I fucking care about. Uber really? Nubernator says,
I'm sure there's, like, really good
if,
stuff inside.
Corey, hey, if you could go anywhere, where in the world would you travel to and why?
Japan.
That's a great question. I'd like to go back to Japan, even though I live there.
Really
I do
really
want
to go
back.
Japan. I want to go to Japan.
You want to go to Japan? But absolutely. Why? But why?
Because I'm into,
you know,
their culture. I'm
being
a big
raised,
weeb.
Being raised where I am and seeing, like, weeaboos or whatever people call them, I've always been fascinated by Japanese culture, because where we kind of, like, grow away from arcade machines.
What's a weeboo?
Well,
it's a person who's, like,
it's like
overly obsessed with, like, Japanese,
like,
culture.
Yeah.
So do you think...
No, here's the thing.
Like, I'm kind of a slight weeb, because I
thing,
like Godzilla
yeah.
and
well,
fucking... we did that podcast with, what's his face? With,
Wooly.
Yeah. And Wooly was, like, this self-prescribed, like, uber weeb.
Yeah.
No, yeah, there's nothing wrong.
Yo, if,
like,
you're down with Japanese stuff, I don't see the problem.
I fucking
I
grew up in Asia.
No, no,
everything I fucking
I'm
love
saying,
is Asian, but I don't
I'm
consider myself
in the
a
sense,
weeb.
I'm saying in the sense with weeboo as a, not a derogatory statement, but as, like, you know, a person who's really into, that's why I said
don't
weeb.
You use it in a derogatory fashion to crack on
it.
People?
That's I don't
what
use
they
it
do,
as a derogatory
I just
statement.
Say it like
I don't call people weeaboos because I understand
well, what
like
is the exact translation
culture.
Of weeboo?
Okay, a weeaboo was an insult to people who were like, I love anime,
stuff.
I love manga, I love, like, you know, Godzilla and Ultraman and all this other just really Japanese
it's
shit.
Not an insult.
Where it's usually, well, it used to be, kind of.
It used to be,
but
we
now,
don't live in that age anymore.
But now it's just kind of like, yeah, I guess I'm kind of a weeb because I like Japanese culture.
Like, I would call myself, I would honestly say, if I invested more time, I could definitely become a weeb. Absolutely, I have no problem saying that. It's like becoming a nerd. It's like not a big deal. What I'm
but
saying.
But don't weebs like crack on other weebs because they aren't as weeb as they are?
If you want to crack
yeah,
on a
every,
weeb because
yeah,
he's
but that's
not
like
as
every
weeb
nerd
as you,
culture.
You're
not really a nerd.
If you want to be like, you're not a nerd because I know the fucking square root of 400. It's like, who cares, faggot? I know like more game knowledge than you could ever know. It's like, whatever you call a weeb is a weeb. But in my opinion, like, the whole culture of, like, weebology.
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 Coin.
Weebology.
Coin.
This guy knows. This guy knows.
Oh, my God.
Basically, I always found the concept.
It's happening.
I always found the fascinating that, like, they still read mangas.
Mangas.
I don't want to get crucified.
Thank you.
And they still, like, do arcades and shit. Like, it's still really popular there. And that concept that they still, like, do that kind of stuff. And the different, I've always been fascinated in the different, like, just that culture. And in general, like, I love the Japanese, like, fashion and style. They have really cool fashion in Japan. Like, Tokyo has an amazing fashion sense. I love, like, the styles and shit.
Yeah, truth
beyond,
no,
like,
it ends up being, like, what we end up emulating.
Yeah,
later on.
Beyond the fashion, beyond the games, and beyond, like, the arcades and stuff. I've always been really fascinated in the Japanese culture over, because American culture, I like Americans. I'm not going to say, like, I'm not an American. I love American culture.
Well, American culture is such a hodgepodge of cultures. When you think about, like, Japanese culture, it's very homogenous. It's very
absolutely.
Isolated, very specific, laser,
maybe my,
crystallized, like, pinpoint.
American culture is summed up, like, you buy a crock pot and you put
exactly.
a bunch of shit in it.
Yeah.
And hope that it works out. The end.
Yeah. And Japan has been very faithful to making sure that what they present to the world has been very much, like, representative of their
it's
country.
It's just cool that you
exactly.
can be, like, on a train through Japan and you'll pass under a statue of a giant robot. It's like shit
that
actually
that.
Happens there.
That idea is awesome to me. Because in America, we're too busy. We're worried about, like, the stuff that's,
like,
you
Gundam
know, wars
statues
and
Godzilla statues. It's like,
yeah,
sweet,
the dude. You wouldn't go through fucking New York and see a giant Gundam statue under
My favorite story, one of my favorite stories as far as, like, geek culture is concerned, is I went to one of the Sega one of the Sega arcades, and there was House of the Dead.
Oh, that's
and there
cool,
were these
man.
Guys. There was this one guy, sorry, specifically one guy, long hair, and he was playing House of the Dead, and he did it with like, it looked like he wasn't even looking
was
at the screen.
Was that his name?
Long hair.
Yeah, long hair. No,
long hair.
That would be a Chinese name, but he was like, he was at the Sega arcade, and he played House of the Dead, and he it looked like he wasn't even looking at the screen, but he was playing two players with both guns, and he did this thing where he was just like, almost like doing a dance while he was playing.
And you know what?
And he was like, bop, bop, bop.
Like that fascinates me.
No, it looked like a Gunkata thing, and he was doing headshot, 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 headshot. Now, to be fair, I didn't even know in House of the Dead that you could do like a straight up headshot kill. Like, I knew that that helped, but I didn't know that like if you only did headshots in House of the Dead, that would actually like, you know.
And you know what? That absolutely fascinates me.
Yeah.
The concept of that.
No,
I would
everyone
never
circled
think
around
that.
And watched it. It was
people
like a very
invested.
Normal
these people who get together and do DDR sessions and like these fucking Japanese like arcades, it's like an Evo tournament. Everyone's lined up and fucking cheering these
people.
That's
exactly what it was like. I mean, back then, watching somebody in like a crowd playing a video game felt a little awkward.
Yeah.
But now that we have like I mean, and this is in, you know, before the 2000s. So now watching people play video games in a fucking huge room is normal and celebrated.
Absolutely.
But when I was doing it, it felt a little awkward. So it is kind of interesting how things have fucking changed since then. So next question we've got, and we're getting close, fellers. This is from Super Slum. If you could run your own convention, what would be the first thing you do?
What? What do you mean the
butts
first
out,
thing?
Titties up.
Fuck a chick.
Everywhere you gotta fuck.
What would you do? Dude, okay.
You're running a convention. First thing you do,
dark
Chris.
Dark room, everyone gets naked and fucks each other.
No, you suck.
Promote
bitch.
Ourselves?
No. I know. See, that's like the logical, like,
a huge auditorium.
People know?
Huge auditorium.
Okay.
Small ball pit.
Absolutely small.
Wait, isn't this like that one con that failed really hard?
Nah.
You're talking about something that exists.
$1,000 you get a you get a wallow in people's urine. Just pistol over the fucking balls.
Yeah. Cash con.
Sleepy cash con.
No, really. We run a con. If we ran a con, what would be the first thing you would do running a con?
Scary dark forest with owls. People walk through a forest and see all these scary owls.
Fuck you, boys.
Dude, let's just get a huge room and release like 50 million owls into
it. It's a
it.
Good idea, dude.
You ever see a video of like the Americans like chilling the fucking, they release the eagle to fucking smash into the window?
Yeah.
It'd be like that.
See, that's a good cringe video.
30 owls smashing into the window constantly every fucking minute, dying.
Trying to escape by grudge.
Fucking
a dark
dying.
Room with these like fucking like stock sound effects that you buy like, chains from like old the 80s, and there's fucking like owls crashing
through the
we'll have your fucking, we'll have your canned narration playing all the time, over and over.
Yeah, just repeating.
There you go, here's my answer.
You'll put, turn it
that's
up really loud,
answer.
And all the owls will scream and die.
I don't know about these motherfuckers' answer.
It's like turn up the bass, it's just like breaking the speakers.
Not only your fucking ears hurting, or just
let's
owls
paint the owls purple too.
Window.
You know what I would do if I ran a convention? I would create a map. Where if there was a thing you needed to see or wanted to see, you'd actually be able to find it.
Wow, that's a good idea.
Because, I know, right? Because I feel like we've gone to some conventions where people like almost hide the rooms that people are supposed to go to in these very like fucking Sisyphean mazes.
Well, they have these fucking like Metroidvania bullshit. Like you can't tell.
Oh, I know.
It's like six fucking rooms above what you're supposed to go on.
And then it's a big surprise that people don't fucking figure it out. But
It's like, oh, I didn't know this is at room 42.
So anyways, if I ran a convention, number one, make a fucking map that people can actually follow. They don't have to download the app and fucking have a degree in fucking physics. All right, next. This is the next and last Patreon question, fellas.
My
you guys ready?
Yeah.
This is from Rodolfo Davis Millet. What's the most fucked up thing you've convinced someone to do?
Convince somebody
I convinced
to do?
With my friends.
Star Sleepy Cabin.
In fifth grade. In fifth grade. In fifth grade.
Hello!
Hey-o!
Wait, that wasn't me.
We convinced the kid to eat dead flies off the windowsill.
Did you really?
Not me, but a couple people.
Balls are fucking sore, dude. Oh, Jesus.
Cool.
No.
Somebody convinced you that your balls were sore?
No, keep going. Sorry.
I convinced the kid
Well, a group of my friends convinced a kid that putting pea water on his face would enhance his, like, get rid of his, like,
acne?
No, not acne.
His face?
Like, fix his, like, ugly? I guess he thought he had stretch marks on his face, so we said, like...
As a kid?
Putting boy pee on your face would enhance the speed of,
boy
like,
pee?
So when I was 14 years old, I didn't convince someone to do this, but... Somebody convinced me. This is in a classroom. This is not even like in the cafeteria or outside of class. In a classroom before the class started. Some students convinced me, and this is how big of a loser I was, that if I squeezed lemon juice into my eyes, it tickled.
Tickled.
Well, dude. So what did you figure out?
Did it hurt?
I figured out.
My dad figured
that
out
it was a lie.
My dad convinced me when I was about 10 years old that if you put a huge square battery in your tongue, that'll tickle too.
What?
Yes. He was very happy to see that it fucking electrocuted me.
Oh my fucking God. Zach, what?
You know, what it's called? What's the actual name for those huge, D battery?
Yeah.
Oh, the ones with the
big,
two.
The big square ones.
They have two. They have the positive and the negative.
It was a light bulb
battery.
He said if you put that to your tongue, it'll tickle. And I fucking screamed and cried when I was 10 years old.
My dad didn't really convince me, but when I was putting tar on a wall to lay down, like.
As you do.
Serious.
Completely serious.
Hot tar on a wall. I got stuff on my finger, and I'm like, Dad, how do I clean this off? He's like, you can't. He's like, it's gonna fucking burn through your skin and touch your bone. And I was freaking out. Like, I was crying as a kid. He's like, don't worry. I was lying. But that was after I was washing my hands and crying. Like, he came in laughing, and he put his hand on my shoulder.
What?
And told
Corey,
me the news.
Corey.
Are you serious?
You know what? This is the last question, but we're here. And this is the season finale, so I think there's a question that a lot of people need answers to.
I haven't asked you this, but...
Is your dad still alive?
Yeah, he's in Florida with his Russian wife.
Does he know about the Sleepy Cast?
No.
Is he real?
Yeah, he's 100% real.
Because there are so many stories about your dad that just blow my goddamn mind.
You know, I talked to Jeff about this. Everybody asks, it's like a fucking... insane, like my dad is like this crazy.
Yeah, his dad's not that weird.
He's
right?
Just, if you listen to the podcast,
he's just like fucking with me when I was younger and like acting like a child. That's
he fucking
really what
made
it comes
you bury tires. He fucking locked you in a basement.
Look, people are weird. If you understand human nature, his dad's not that fucking strange.
Really, what it comes down to is my dad was just sort of a child. If you want to know the honest truth, my dad's father died when he was 13. So he didn't really know how to be a father when he was 13. And not to mention, his
he
mom...
He didn't have you with her. He didn't have you with her.
Yeah, no. His mom gave him everything he ever wanted. If his room was dirty, she would clean it up. He had no idea of the concept...
What age was he when he had you,
responsibility.
Corey?
He was like, I don't know, like he was 40-something.
Oh.
Maybe 30.
He grew up like a coddled faggot and like everything was kind of handed to him.
Exactly. Everything was handed to him. He became very narcissistic. So the concept of a kid was just like he would keep him around and love him, but he would also fuck with him. And his idea of fucking with him was just like, you know, as if it was like a college kid he was just fucking with when he was like 8.
Corey, do you want kids?
No. Well, maybe when I'm older.
You don't want to repeat the same process.
I don't want to teach my kids to be like, hey.
What would you teach your kids?
Go stick your hand
Corey,
in the thorn
Corey,
bush.
What would you teach your kids?
What is the top three lessons you would teach your son if you had a son right now?
Three lessons. The three things they need to know, Corey. Your kid.
Sex, like porn and the concept of that. I would teach him porn at a young age.
You threw that out really fast.
That's what it's always on my mind.
Number two.
I would teach him about the difference between reaching for something and working for something.
Number two, teach your kid how to make spaghetti, man. If you know how to make spaghetti, you know how to do a million fucking things.
Number three, I would teach him basic living advice, like how to wash your clothes and fold it, and how to cook food with something I never fucking learned.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You can't do that.
You could teach your kid basic living knowledges. Okay. And number three... And then I would encourage him to influence him in the porn and stuff. And then when he draws porn pictures
at
school...
So number one is sex, and the last one is you'd encourage him in porn.
Yeah, if he drew people fucking at school, I would be like, was it hot? And then if they said no, I would beat his fucking ass. I've been, get on that, motherfucker! You have an audience now!
You would beat your son because he's not drawing hot enough porn at a young age?
Look at these titties! Look at these titties!
I support your decisions, Corey. Can I be Uncle Stamper?
Always, dude.
Yes, dude, yes!
I'd be like, those titties look like raindrops. Across his face.
And I'll be like, listen, I know your dad can be a little tough sometimes, but they have to hang off the shoulder like teardrops, asshole, and I'll smack the shit out of him.
Man, I'd be a bad parent. Listen, if I was a dad right now, I'd be like, eat your vegetables, go to bed on time, and then I'd go to bed.
All you have to do is feed them and make sure they don't die. Next question. Oh, wait, that's it.
That's it.
Whoa, dude.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've gotten through the Patreon questions.
Oh, what do we have next?
We slayed them, the bitch.
Reddit Q&A.
Yeah.
Reddit Q&A.
Reddit Q&A, pussy weed. 420, dude. I give a fuck. Pussy, fuck that pussy. Yeah. In my eyes, dude.
Gay.
All right. No. One time I threw up a monster on the pussy.
That'd be a really funny alarm.
So gay.
Gay.
So not gay.
Shut up, you
let's
fuck.
Let's change it. Let's move on to the reddit.com.
We'll be right back after our commercial break.
Welcome to Mint Butthole Freshness.
Better stop.
Where you can put a mint in your butthole and get the fresh scent of your
feel
butthole.
The breeze of the Alpine.
Right up your ass!
What's my L toys? Put up your ass! Put them in your asshole, dude! Buy them and put them in your ass, dude. Come on.
Put these mints.
This is the worst commercial ever.
Put these mints up
your butt. I would buy L toys. Fuck you!